Anderson County Mavericks. This afternoon's game features the Clinton Dragons and your Anderson County Mavericks. The colors for this afternoon's baseball game are presented by members of the Anderson County High School Navy JRTC Color Guard. The unit was formed in August 2001 and is composed of 138 cadets. The Color Guard members this afternoon are Cadet Senior Chief Petty Officer Dylan Villalev of Andersonville, Cadet Lieutenant Commander Audrey Wood from Maynardville, Cadet Ensign Jason Holder from High School, and Cadet Ensign Roman Ferguson from Clinton. And now to honor America, we ask that you all rise. Gentlemen, please remove your caps and remain standing until the colors are retired as we play our national anthem. Here are your starting lineups. First, we're Clinton Dragons, leading off the catcher number 2, Jason Mack, center fielder number 14, Harrison Schiller. Batting third, the right fielder number 32, Isaiah Slavin. Batting cleanup, first baseman number 19, Garrett Lee. Batting fifth.
Welcome into Clinton Dragon Baseball here on Dragon Division. I'm Matt Hagen alongside
Macaulay White
from last night. Macaulay White did a fantastic job helping us out with the Anderson County stats. Coming into tonight's game after a hard loss last night, but it was a good game between both teams.
Agreed, yes, sir.
What are you looking forward to tonight?
I'm looking to see, from my opinion, if the Mavericks are going to get them back.
I'm hoping for a good game.
Either way, I think it's going to be a good game.
I know we did get some slightly good news since last Monday night, if you want to talk about Lane.
Lane Fletcher, yeah. We know that his elbow's not broke, but he will be out for definitely towards the end of the season. Hopefully he'll be back for our final district plays for that region play, but all in all,
good news for what happened.
Yeah, exactly. It's at least nothing's broken.
We all want to say congratulations on him not being as hurt as what we all thought he was. I'm actually going to pull up the starting lineup for the Anderson County Mavericks if you want to go ahead and read those off.
So starting on the plate for, behind the plate, Ty Wilson. He is a junior for Anderson County. On the mound, we have Luke Langford, left-handed. Morgan Clark playing first base, Alex Bond at second base, his brother Aiden Bond, a senior, at shortstop, Reese Wilkerson on third base, Trey Rowe playing left field, Easton Beatty playing right field, and Trent Strickland, a junior for Anderson County, at center field.
What do you think of that lot? What do you think of that lineup? What is Coach Boynton looking for tonight after what happened last night?
Based off of last time, I believe we're looking to get some hits. We had a couple opportunities last game that we just didn't quite perform in. So I know Ty Wilson came up with a couple loaded bases, runner on first and second situations, and we just had no luck there. So I think today we're really looking for some opportune hits and a clean defense played.
Yeah, I know we're looking for clean defense from both teams. We had a little bit of issues with that both times. Sorry, you saw the camera moving. We're getting it adjusted. I got the stats pulled up right now for Lane. This will be his third appearance. He is
Luke Langford, ERA of 1.17. He's only walked 8 people out of 2 appearances. He's faced 53 batters, and he's got 12 innings pitched with 14 Ks.
Nice. That's a wonderful start for him for this year. The Dragons are going to have a little bit of a change to their lineup. You're going to see J.P. Robbins making his first ever start as a true freshman.
Yes,
he came in yesterday as relief for Garrett Davis, who got tossed early in the game.
Yes, sir.
So he's got to miss a couple games, but J.P.'s a really good backup for him for being a freshman that he is.
Yes, sir. I mean, it's always good to see talent young, especially for a program.
So right now, well, So Chase Mack is going to lead us off. Chase Mack, on the season, I'm going to pull up his stats right now. He is batting .333, has 4 RBIs, and 1 double this season. He's got the tied for the highest batting average out of the players who are going to play today for the Dragons.
I believe Morgan Clark has our highest.
Morgan Clark does have your highest with a .375 batting average. First pitch right down the middle for strike one. Nice pitch to open up the game. Dragons wearing their road orange uniforms tonight. As I get this up so I can keep our stats going. Next pitch.
Luke Langford with the ball outside.
There you go. 1-1 count. Beautiful day for baseball, too.
Couldn't
deny
beautiful
this
weather.
One. I'm kind of glad we didn't go swimming yesterday instead of playing baseball, which we all probably would have. Lined into the gap between first and second for the opening. For the first hit of the game for Jace Mack. Winding out my camera just a hair. So next up to bat will be Harrison Shelton, the starting pitcher from last night. Harrison Shelton is batting .320 with 1 home run and 7 RBIs this season. What did you see last night out of Harrison when he was pitching?
Shoot, truth be told, I wasn't completely paying attention to him. I was really focused on my team. I know he was keeping the Dragons in the game, so he didn't quit. That's always a good thing to see.
He didn't quit. It was a pitcher's duel all of last night, all the way until that sixth inning and the unfortunate incident that happened in the sixth inning.
Yes, sir. That's when the game got a little questionable.
It did get a little questionable.
Oh, my bad. Luke Langford with a strike.
0-1 count right now. I was looking to pull up Harrison Shelton's batting number so I could update him as the at-bat goes. Remember, we got Jace Mack at first with a leadoff single.
Foul ball, fouled back. No balls, 2 strikes. Luke Langford ahead.
I see Coach Boynton, we're going to retrieve that foul ball.
Yeah.
And you gotta have the coaches help out a little bit during the games.
I mean, I agree with that completely, but I also think that our coaches do a lot. So, I know we got some JV guys in the dugout, so we got plenty of guys that can be helping out right now.
Yeah, I like the black and white uniforms. Those are some of my favorite ones I've seen. I've never seen you all wear them, but that's a beautiful look on this field.
Well, we appreciate that.
So we got all black, time called, or do they call time called? I guess by Harrison Shelton. It was a late time call. I didn't see him put his hand up. I think he just yelled time. And the umpire stepped out. Once again, you got Mack on first. Shelton at the plate. You got Isaiah Slavin on deck. The pitch.
Wild off speed there.
Just
a bit outside.
That's what I was going with. You read my mind on that one just a little bit.
But, yeah, no. I think Luke Langford will be okay once he settles down. He knows he's not the biggest dog in the dog park, but he knows that if he holds himself together, and he's also got a team behind him, so. A little bit of a chase there.
Yeah, I don't know what Harrison was looking at. That was a nice little break on, and he got fooled and realized it right after he took it off his shoulders. He's like, I got to swing anyway. Keeps the count at 1-2. Once again, a really nice day for baseball here at Anderson County High School at Merrill Albright Field.
Yes, sir.
Little ground ball. Second base over to shortstop. Not in time,
the Bond brothers just don't quite get it around.
Hey, at least they got
lead runner out.
At least they got the lead runner out. That'll help out. Still got a runner at first now. That'd be labeled a 6-4 fielder's choice. Put Shelton at first for Isaiah Slavin.
Yes, sir. First righty faced by Luke Langford.
Slavin with 3 doubles on the year, team lead 9 RBIs, and a .296 batting average.
Runner going.
And a pop up by Slavin as Shelton has to retreat quick to get back, and it's going to land.
No man's land.
And it gets away, but Bond was out. Or who was that at shortstop again?
That was our pitcher, Luke Langford, backing up the second baseman.
That's one of the best plays I've seen on as a pitcher, just getting back there in case that ball got away.
Yes, sir.
So a little dribbler for a single for Isaiah Slavin. We'll put runners at first and second with just one out for the Dragons as Garrett Lee comes up to bat. I know you know a lot of these players, being a senior yourself, and you've been over here.
I know a couple of them. I wouldn't say I know a lot. I know a few of them. I've played travel ball with Garrett Lee. He had a little bit of a rough summer, not going to lie, but, I mean, he stayed in there, and he definitely had a few good hits. So.
Now Garrett Lee heading over to Milligan. Along with one of your players.
Aiden Bond. Yes, sir. Our shortstop.
That's going to be a good thing, seeing those two team up together, see how they react.
Yeah. Go from rivals to family.
That's always good. It's rivals, but it is it's a family in the county when you're not playing each other.
Yes, sir.
Time called by Lee. So a 1-0 count, one out, runners on first and second.
Luke Langford stepping off the back.
Looking at trying to get Harrison to overthink trying to take off for third. Not sure if he will or not, but he does have a few stolen bases this year. I'll have to go back through my stats and look at that in just a minute.
Luke Langford getting back in there. Make the count now 1-1.
Nice pitch to even up the count right there. Garrett Lee was not looking for that. He was not looking at that one. Which said 1-1 count. Runner going to third.
And he is out at called safe.
They called safe.
Called safe.
Did they say he was off the bag when he went?
I believe so.
So it'll be a stolen base for Shelton, getting him over to third base. Now you got runners at first and third with just one out, and Garrett Lee up to bat with a 1-1 count.
2-1.
Thank you.
all good.
Since I'm working on the stats at the same time, I'm glad I've got my colleague right here helping, or Mo out here.
Bouncing back and forth.
Mo out here helping me out. Mo, like I said, did a fantastic job last night. Everyone's been talking about it today at ACCTC and at AC, just how much fun he had. We got runner going for second. It's going to be an easy stolen base without a throw. Smart move right there by the catcher.
Yes, sir.
If it was me behind the plate, I probably would have thrown that one. I wouldn't have had the instinct to hold it in case the runner tried to come home from third. So I give him credit. It was a really good move right there. A little bit outside.
Just a bit outside.
Just a bit outside.
Luke Langford. Not quite getting all the way through his throw there. Full count.
But he does have a base to give, though.
He does have a base to give, but he's also got two in scoring position, so he's cutting it
right.
Close.
He's wanting a ground ball right here to try to end the inning.
That would be optimal. Or a strikeout. That puts us with two outs and a runner, or runners, plural,
right.
On third and second base.
So D.H. Jackson Webb up to bat now. Jackson is 250 with four RBIs and four hits on the season. First
ground ball.
Pitch, ground ball straight to Morgan Clark, and they called it a fair ball, and he steps on first for the third out of the inning. So no runs on one hit, no errors, and two left on base. What are you looking forward to in the bottom of this inning?
I'm looking for Anderson County to hopefully pull out here, stick it through. If we could get a couple chicken scratches on the board, that'd be great.
That would be ideal. So while we're waiting on that, I'm going to pull up, once I find it on my list, the Dragon starters. And I'll read off those Dragon starters as I put my camera up top right here. The Dragons are starting Sam Duggins, a senior pitcher. Got Jace Mack at catcher, Garrett Lee at first, J.P. Robbins making his first start of the season at second, Alex Duggins at shortstop, Braden Hensley at third, Isaiah Slavin at right field, Harrison Shelton at center field, and Dallas Beats at left field. Once again, I want to give, just me personally, a big shout out to the freshman, J.P. Robbins, making only his first start of the season, but being on the game back-to-back nights, or back-to-back games after what happened on Monday night.
I mean, that's definitely big for any freshman of any community or any school. It's a lot of pressure, but it shows you how much faith that the team has in you.
And Sam Duggins, other starter. Sam Duggins making his third appearance tonight. He's 1-0 on the season with a 16-1 win over Campbell County. 1.31 ERA, 8 strikeouts, and to 2 walks. Not really a bad line for only one start on the season.
That's not bad at all.
Leading off, go ahead and tell us who.
I was going to say, leading off for the Anderson County Mavericks tonight, we have Aiden Bond, the shortstop. He is committed to Milligan, and he's got a batting average of .321 with 9 hits and 4 doubles for the season.
He also has 3 RBIs. That's a great stat line, too, just this early in the season. Aiden having a great – he had a great game on Monday as well. He was one of them. Him and Alex kept the Mavericks in it all the way until that unfortunate incident happened, which we don't wish on anybody.
No.
Maybe we can get Lane up here one day when we can, like during the district tournament.
Yes, sir.
And have him talk on the game as well. That'd be a good one. If
yes,
he came up here during tonight's game, that would help.
I was gonna say, I know he's down there with the boys in the dugout right now.
Yeah,
he's not playing though, but
yeah, if you get in touch with him and you want to see if he wants to come up and say something, I'll let you talk to him between innings. That way we can talk to him about what kind of season he's been having and just what it means to him still being here.
For sure.
As we get ready to go, I'll have to update my stats right here to show us that we're actually now in the top or the bottom of the first inning.
Aiden Bond stepping in the box.
First pitch.
Ground ball makes it through for a single.
And gets by Dallas Beats in the
left
field.
And Bond's going to take second.
He's going to run all the way to third.
Bond's going to continue to third.
Beats throws.
And he's going to be on third base comfortably.
Hits the shortstop on the cover. Nice little triple there. I'm going to call that a triple. That was a nice little triple to begin the game.
Great heads up base running.
Very good base running right there.
The third baseman, number 10, Reese Wilkerson.
Now for the Anderson County Mavericks, batting second, Reese Wilkerson. He's a junior for Anderson County. He's played 9 games total with 7 hits, 6 RBIs, and a batting average of .280 out of 29 plate appearances.
Not bad at all.
Reese Wilkerson swinging on the first pitch.
Fouls it back into the netting. And this time, one of your batters comes out and gets it instead of the coach.
Ty Wilson.
Great job. Nice one on that one, Ty. Nice job being heads up on that.
Reese Wilkerson called strike on him. Puts the count at no balls, two strikes. Runner on third.
See what kind of mix-up Duggins wants to come up with right here. Here's the third pitch. Ground ball towards third. Picked up by the third baseman. Checks the runner back. Throws it high and off the bag.
And Reese Wilkinson is safe. Single. Anderson County with runners on first and third. Ty Wilson now coming up to bat. He has 8 hits for the season. 5 RBIs. 9 games played. And a batting average of .258. He's an absolute dog behind the plate.
He is, as he shut. As he's shown, making sure he got that one big out on Monday night at home.
Yes, sir.
Might have been a little bit argued by Coach Stacy on there, but I don't know what, that was a clean play
that we saw.
He was ready for it.
I was going to say, I know he's battling a little bit of a sprained wrist or something. Not quite feeling great on his catching hand, but.
First pitch low and inside for ball one.
He's not going to sit down for anything like that. If he can play through it, he'll definitely do it. Strike on the outside corner for Ty Wilson. Or not for Ty Wilson, on Ty Wilson.
On Ty Wilson.
One ball, one strike.
We got to try to stay a little bit unbiased on this one, which, I mean,
it's a good
game either way. These are always close games. I have not seen a blowout yet since I've been working with both, since I've been looking at both teams. Popped him up. Will it be out of play?
Ball may still be in play.
Turn it down there.
Oh, and it is a dropped foul ball. No out.
No out, dropped foul ball, like White said, to make the count 1-2. Love the music being played up here, too. Got to have a little bit of fun when you're up here in the booth.
Oh, for sure.
1-2 count with runners at the corners in the bottom of the first inning.
Ty Wilson with a bloop. Oh, and an error made by the third baseman.
But he eats it right there. That was Alex Duggins. Actually, that was shortstop. That was Alex Duggins. But they're calling time right now. Coach Stacy's going to go out and talk to Sam Duggins after Ty Wilson reached on an error.
Yes, sir.
So let's see, Ty. I'm looking on my get mine to pull this up as Ty Wilson reached on an error and Morgan Clark coming up to bat next. Morgan Clark had a phenomenal game. Yeah, Shane, he's had a phenomenal season, too. I'll let you go ahead and take that one.
I was going to say, Morgan Clark committed to Southwest Virginia. Great guy in the classroom and outside of the classroom. He's played 9 games total with 9 hits, played appearances of 32, batting average of .375, the highest for Anderson County baseball, and 5 RBIs with 5 stolen bases.
And I'll give my own little shout-out to Morgan. Morgan's actually one of my students at ACCTC, one of the best students that I've had. Always a joy to work with. Never wants to have a bad day. Always tries to have fun. First pitch blooped over the shortstop or second base's head. Going to make it all the way to the wall.
Aiden Bond score.
Throws it in. They 2 runs will score, making it a quick 2-0 lead.
Coming up next, we have Trent Strickland for the Anderson County Mavericks, batting in the 5 hole. He's also played 9 innings with 6 hits and 5 RBIs. He has a fielding percentage of 1,000.
That's a really good start to the season.
Out of center field, he's a very solid player, very athletic. As previously mentioned, he also plays for the football team and basketball team. Strickland watching a ball.
A basketball team and football team that had some, they've had some very good seasons the last couple of years.
Yes, sir.
The unfortunate way they got eliminated in the district tournament or the region tournament. Pops him up. Sam gets him underneath it. Garrett Lee going foul territory. Makes the catch down the first baseline. Almost looked like
he
was going to drop
sunglasses.
That one. But now the score.
Number one.
Still. Go ahead.
I was going to say, now batting for Anderson County, the 6-hole Alex Bond. He has played 7 games with 7 hits. And he pitched against y'all. Or pitched against Clinton Dragons on Monday, the previous game to the series.
He had a great game on Monday.
Yeah, he held his own up there for sure. Ground ball that may
So we'll get to this.
No play.
With Eden or one, another run will score, making it a 3-0 game.
Anderson County building a little bit of energy early here. Clinton Dragons. I'm sure they're getting a little antsy and ready to fight back here. So a lot of competition. Big rivalry here. Easton Beatty now up for Anderson County. He also has a fielding percentage of 1,000 with a batting average of 333, right behind Morgan Clark for the second highest batting average on the team with 7 RBIs.
Easton, here's a roll one over, foul. Nice little call on that one for an 0-1 count. I'm still going through trying to make sure I catch up on everyone.
No, I understand. You got a lot you're keeping up with over there.
Yeah, we don't have our third partner, either Brian Ford or Anthony Hinkle, that were here with us Monday night.
We do not have the third Musketeer with us.
A little bit low and outside. Looked like he was in the dirt just a hair for that one. I want to say Coach Boynton's done a great job getting this field ready after all the rain we all saw yesterday.
Yes, sir. We had a tarp pull last night with a little bit of practice. Great. Easton Beatty ground ball to the pitcher.
Nice job.
A little
job.
Bit of a difficult decision, but makes it to first for the out.
Smart move, though, checking the runners to make sure they weren't going to advance to home on that one. Nice out right there.
Number 18, Gavin Hill.
Nice out right there for Sam Duggins, the starting pitcher.
Yes, sir. Took responsibility of that play himself. Batting Gavin Hill. Has a little bit of a rough season. Only had 10 ABs, but batting average of 200, which isn't terrible. But we'll see what he's got to offer here. I know he's had a couple clutch hits here in times of need.
First pitch from Sam Duggins is grounded towards the third base side. Picked up by the shortstop, overthrown to Garrett Lee, who had to jump out of the way. One run will try to score. One run will score, and they hold the runner at third on the throwing error.
Two-run score there, I believe.
Two runs.
Morgan Clark makes it in. So does Alex Bond from second base.
Okay, so we do have runners at the corner. Is it runners at the corners?
I'm no, sir. We have just a runner Gavin Hill on first base.
Okay, so two more runs score, making it 5-0.
Luke Blankford.
Go ahead.
One of the comedians of the team here.
Number 20, Luke Blankford.
With the I Shot the Sheriff for the walk-up song. Very laid-back guy. Loves to go fishing. He's got one hit on the season. Only had 10 plate appearances. Not the best, but he's holding his own on the mound for the team, so he's definitely doing his fair share.
First pitch is in there for strike one. Sam Duggan's trying to get out of this inning now without giving up any more runs to the Mavericks and just keeping it a 5-0 lead for Anderson County. Second pitch, swing and a miss for strike two.
Luke Langford getting a little bit big for himself there.
And this is one of my favorite battles. It's the pitcher-on-pitcher duel.
Oh, yeah.
I always love to see these.
You as a batter, as a pitcher, understand that, hey, he's probably going to throw me something that I'm not expecting. So you have a tendency to overthink as a hitter.
Yeah, Mac tried to frame that one, but it looked like it was just enough outside that the umpire didn't want to call that one.
Yes, sir.
We got a perfect view from up here to see if it's inside or outside.
Definitely. Ball appears to be a little bit high, but puts 2-2 count.
With two outs and a runner at first. Once again, 5-0 your score here at Merle Albright Field, home of the Anderson County Mavericks.
Swing and miss for strike three.
So five runs on what appears to be
a couple errors.
Two errors, three hits, and one left on base.
Still plenty of game left, though, so.
Exactly.
The winds could change.
We saw that last night. Monday night, excuse me. I still think last night because the game was supposed to happen yesterday.
A little bit of a confused schedule with all that going on.
Now I got to make sure I get to the right scorecard for each inning. I'm actually not going to end up doing stats since we only have two people on here. I'm not going to update any of the stats. We're just going to keep it the way it is.
Yes, sir.
Make it easier for both of us so we're not jumping back and forth.
I agree. Luke Langford comes back out for the second inning.
Go ahead and talk about Luke. What have you learned? What have you learned from him since you came in?
I've been friends with Luke for a long time. I remember we played Little League together. So we've been friends. We went to different schools and split up. Had a little bit of a gap there, but I will say Luke Langford definitely helped me make some good friends. He's definitely a great influence on and off the field. He stays aware of his situations and surroundings. He's got a great family. He's got a father that's a wildlife officer, so He's a very level-headed kid. He loves to go fishing. I don't know if y'all saw on the news. He actually had his girlfriend catch a walleye night after prom. So he's a good dude. He's a goofball.
The second baseman, number 23, J.P. Rock.
He also shoots competitively. Has another sport. So
yeah, that's a fantastic. That's something I haven't seen. I haven't seen much of around here. Not many people take that up as a sport.
I shoot as well with him. Hey, I'm the one who got him into that.
Hey, that's a good friend right there.
He's definitely outgrown me.
Now we want to say, top of the second inning, J.P. Robbins, the freshman, making his first start of the season, takes a call right down the middle for strike one.
Luke Langford working ahead here.
J.P., the starting second baseman, came in to fill in for Garrett Davis yesterday. See how he does on this 0-1 pitch. Pops him up going towards Morgan Clark at first. It's going to catch. Nice
Morgan
catch.
Clark with a great
Morgan
play.
Catch. And even better, I'm just going to make the joke since he's my student, even better face plan afterwards. But he does make the first out of the inning. And I will tell Morgan that I said he had made one of the best face plants I've seen in a long time. But he got the first out.
Team acrobat right there. Him and Trey Rowe.
Next up for the Clinton Dragons, Alex Duggins, the starting third baseman tonight.
Luke Langford missing high outside.
Alex Duggins plays a lot of the infield, especially when there's a little bit of challenges. He's been at second a lot this season. This is one of his first starts at third. Next pitch, inside corner for strike two, or strike one. 1-1 count now. 1-1 count, one out with a 5-0 lead for Anderson County.
Called strike two.
I couldn't tell if that one was inside, a little bit inside or right down the middle, but it was in a good location.
I think it was a little bit low from what I was seeing, but who knows?
Umpire might have a little bit of a lower strike zone than most of them do.
Yeah.
But a 1-2 count, one out, payoff pitch coming high and outside for ball two.
I wouldn't be surprised if we saw an off-speed of some type right here. I mean, it's still early in the game to be breaking out off-speed, but I wouldn't be surprised if we see a little bit to try and put them away here.
2-2 pitch.
Fastball.
Foul back. It was a little bit more inside. Duggins was working to try to get that go inside out for that swing, but was able to make contact.
Yes, sir.
Mavericks looking to even up the series after the loss on Monday and make sure the district stays at a 1-1 on the season. 2-2 pitch. Swing and a miss for strike three to Alex Duggins.
Puts two outs on the inning. And now batting, y'all have Braden
Hensley. The starting shortstop tonight. Braden Hensley doing a great job. Or starting third baseman, sorry. Third baseman tonight. Doing a great job on the season. For a while, he was leading the team as he takes ball one. He was leading the team in RBIs until Harrison Shelton hit that one home run to give him 9 RBIs on the season. So 1-0 count to Hensley. Next pitch. In there on the inside corner, strike one. That umpire likes that inside corner. If you can hit it, looks like he's going to call that one all night.
Yeah, the umpire appears to be calling both corners.
Which is a great.
Which is no complaint as a pitcher. Makes it a little tougher on the hitter, but sometimes you just got to work with what the umpire's calling. Can't argue what he says.
Nope, swing and a miss for strike two. Hensley swung out of his shoes a little bit on that one, trying to dig for it. Once again, the Dragons in their road orange today with black numbers, white trim. Mavericks in their home black uniforms, white numbers, white trim. Pitch popped him up. Langford and no catcher coming back for it. Wilson makes the out for the third out of the inning. Nice little play right there. Wilson calling off Langford to make sure he got that third out. So we got a 5-0 score midway through the second inning. As who's getting ready to come up to bat for the Mavericks?
I believe Aiden Bond is coming up for the Mavericks here. Back at the top of the lineup, I believe. So
yeah, that is right. We did go through the full batters in the first inning. Let's see who's coming. They are. Sam Duggins will still be pitching for the Dragons as we begin the second inning. Sam Duggins
really nothing he could do about that last inning. I mean, he didn't do anything wrong.
He pitched really well.
Exactly, just, yeah.
The balls were hit in just the right spot that the infielders couldn't get it. And then
exactly.
a few throwing errors, which it's still early in the season. You're still working through your mechanics.
Yes, sir.
The second
sir.
District game.
Also a lot of jitters here, I'd say. A lot of energy, a lot of excitement, maybe a little bit of anxiety here. I know there's definitely some on our Anderson County side, so and that's nothing to be ashamed of. I mean, that's part of it being early in the season with this big of a competition.
Yeah, it's different. We usually play each other towards the end of the season,
yes, sir.
Like last year, not to open district play, but that might be a good thing to get us ready for district tournament right at the very end.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think it's better to put the pressure on early. That way both teams can adjust that way instead of it's not as big of a shocker or a learning curve whenever we get later down the road.
Exactly. And another thing I wanted to point out that I really like out here is the Mavs that are in the right – that's in right center field up there on the wall. Just the way it was made out. I teach the digital arts. I like the little shadow that they added to it to make it look more 3D.
I cannot remember the guy's name that did that, but he did all the painting. I know my dad and a couple other parents helped paint the wall, I believe, and they also helped build the wall, but I cannot remember. Aiden Bond coming back up. His first AB, he had a triple.
A triple and scored.
And scored.
First pitch from Duggins. Low and inside for ball one. Pull up my stat sheet here since I'm not going to end up doing what I did in the last things. It just takes too much effort when I'm by myself or with just one other person. Strike on the outside corner. That was a little bit close on that one. I'll give it to him. Like you said, he's calling both corners.
Exactly, and he's giving it to both teams. So as long as he's fair with it, that's all that matters.
Line towards center. Running back is Shelton, who gets the easy fly out. So one up, one down here in the top of the second inning.
Third baseman, Reese Wilkerson.
Reese Wilkerson coming up to bat here. Had a single in his first AB. See if he can carry his momentum here.
Yeah. Wilkerson up, Wilson on deck, Clark in the hole. Duggan's looking to see if he can get two for two in the start of this inning. Outside and low for ball one. Sam Duggins, this is making his first start against Anderson County in his four-year career, I'm pretty sure on that one. This probably does have a little bit of jitters.
Yep. I mean, I know I would. It doesn't matter what game.
Nice strike. That one looked like it was either inside or right down the middle.
That had some great movement on it, and that was great placement by the pitcher and the catcher.
Mac, one of the best catchers I've seen, along with Wilson, two of the best catchers I've seen in this district in a long time. Ground ball at the middle. Nice pickup right there by Sam Duggins. Throws it over to Garrett Lee for the second out of the inning. Sam Duggins, that's the second time he's had an out on his own. There you go. That's what I was trying to figure out.
Pitcher fielding practice, but I guess it'd be more like a pitcher play. Ty Wilson coming back.
He reached on an error in his first at bat.
Yes, sir.
That error also scored the first and second run of the game, swinging a miss for strike one. No, that error did not. That error made it bases loaded. When he scored,
yes,
out, that
yes,
error
sir.
Made it bases
I believe
loaded.
So. Count of no ball, one strike.
From the stretch. Pops him up down the right field, left field line, but foul. I like the view from up here. The only thing my camera doesn't like is it can't see from corner to corner, but it could be a lot worse. I've been at some fields, such as, I won't say any names but Halls, where if you're in the press box, you can only see half the field.
That's a bummer.
So you got an 0-2 count. He pops it up again, but this one goes out of play.
And it is caught for the third out of the inning.
Nice job. And that was Alex Duggins on the third out of the inning. So Sam Duggins did what he wanted to do. He got a 1-2-3 inning after allowing nine to bat in the top of the first. And there we go. We see Lane Fletcher walking out.
Yes, sir.
Glad to see him out here. I'm glad he suited up out here to support his team.
Yes, sir. Another great thing about Lane Fletcher, I mean, he's definitely a team guy. He told Coach Boynton while he was on first base, and he was laying there. He had the ability to yell at Coach B and said, "This isn't my last game for you, Coach." He said, I will be back, he said. And, you know, he might not be on the field exactly where he wants to be, but he's still back out here to support us. to support his family.
And that's what you want to see for yes. from anyone who yes. gets hurt on, no matter what the team is. You want to see them come back out and support their own.
For sure. I know Morgan Clark was definitely feeling pretty bad about what happened. He wanted to take a lot of the blame, but, I mean, that's part of the game, and Morgan Clark also, he realized that, but
yeah, I talked to Morgan this morning. He said, it hit him hard, but he's just glad it wasn't worse than it actually
yes,
was.
Yes, yeah.
And I know you all are happy for that.
Oh, for sure. I mean, as Coach B said, and he said this to me when I got injured, and he says it to almost anybody, or almost, I mean, everybody. He says there's more than the ability to play with the game of baseball. You learn a lot of life lessons through the game. You learn a lot of teamwork skills, communication skills. I mean, he says that, yes, we face injuries, but there's also things that are your health is more important than winning a game, no matter what game it is. And I really do like that Coach B puts players before the game.
I agree, and that's a perfect way of saying it. And I, once again, want to give a shout-out. Morgan Clark just being a great team player. And
Yes.
It's not about it's we, not me with him.
Yes.
It's the whole
yes.
team.
It is the whole team before himself.
As the 9 batter for the Dragons, Dallas Beats comes up to bat to lead off the top of the 3rd inning. First pitch, low and away for ball 1. I like this combination, too. Just each team almost wearing solid colors. I like the white pants on the Anderson
yes.
County. Swing and a miss there to make it 1-1. So you got Beats, Mack, and Shelton due up for bat in this inning for the Dragons.
Could be a very big inning here.
Could be. It also could be a great 3rd inning for Luke.
Yes,
he
sir.
He pops it up going towards Morgan Clark at first. Morgan Clark in foul
the
territory. Makes
acrobat. Makes the play.
Makes the acrobatic play. I was going to call it a Willie Mays style play, but nice
yeah.
out right
no,
there.
That's a great way of putting it.
That's the second time Clark's made one of those outs today.
I would say that's one of Morgan Clark's great attributes. He's very heads up, very aware, and he's willing to go out and make plays that might not necessarily be in his territory, but he's willing to go out and make the best effort he can for the team.
Jace Mack up to bat now, catcher, singled in his first at bat, makes contact, picked up by the third shortstop, throws it over in
the
time.
Second out.
Nice one pitch out there for Anderson County. Mack had a good little read on it. Got underneath third baseman's hand, but your shortstop picked it up.
Harrison Shelton coming up to the plate for the Clinton Dragons here. Looking to get on base, I would assume.
he got on base the first time, made it over at third, but he was stranded at third in the top of the first inning. Harrison Shelton going to Carson Newman next year. First pitch. Just a bit outside.
A little bit wild there.
Just a little bit.
Luke Lankford
doesn't want to show that he's perfect. He doesn't want to show that he's going perfect in the inning. He wants to show a little bit.
No, definitely.
Ground ball down the first baseline and foul. Almost barehanded caught by Coach Witt over at the first baseline, but couldn't quite make the catch. I think his son could have made that catch, but we'll see. Got to have a little bit of fun when you're doing this.
Oh, for sure.
I know you've had a blast joining us for this series. Hopefully,
oh no, I've definitely enjoyed it.
If you're not, hopefully you come back this season. You don't have to join us again in the playoffs. They're swinging.
That would be the
two.
Goal. Definitely would rather be on the field than up here. But hey, being up here, I'm not gonna complain at all. I mean, great opportunity, and once again, thank you.
Oh yeah, not
for,
a problem.
Having me come up here.
Thank you for joining us. Inside, going to hit him right in the shoulder.
It's a foul ball.
He said it hit him in the shoulder. He was calling it hit him in the elbow. But they're saying I couldn't tell from that one. We're getting told it was at the bottom. They're going to ask first base, which is the smart thing to do. Always get help for that call. And the Jeopardy music playing. They are going to call a foul ball. So you were right on that one. They're saying it hit the butt of the bat. Still a 1-2 count. Shelton not really happy with that. Coach Stacy wanted to come talk just to make sure of why they ruled it that way. Don't see him too animated right now, so he's not really saying that it's a bad call. He just wants to get an explanation.
Be 100% sure of it.
And, yeah, see, he got the explanation. He walks away. That's one thing I like about Coach Boynton, Coach Stacy.
Not causing any unnecessary conflict.
Right. They want to make sure that the game's called. They just want to know why it was called a certain
way.
And that makes sense.
Back in the AB here. One ball, two strikes with two outs. Nobody on.
The pitch low and away for ball two. Shelton working the count even now. 2-2 count, two outs. Bunch of twos on the board except for the score, which is 5-0 Anderson County.
Yes, sir.
I know you want to try to get a few more runs across in the bottom to maybe not have to play any longer, but we'll see.
I mean, at the end of the day, I think both teams are wanting this win just as bad. So
they are. And
Anderson County's wanting to break even, and Clinton's wanting to go home with the series. So
we're all wanting to keep up with Gibbs right now, who's up 2-0 in the standings because they were playing Scott to open it up. Nothing against Scott. High and outside for ball four. So Shelton does walk to get on base. Second time he's been on base tonight as Isaiah Slavin comes up to bat for the Dragons. Slavin did a fantastic job in relief last night, coming in just for the top of the seventh inning. Slavin with his traditional green gloves. Checks the runner at first, throws it over. Gets a little bit away from Morgan Clark, but no harm, no foul with where it ended up. Like I said, Slavin with his traditional green batting gloves, just like Harrison Sheldon with his traditional pink bat, as we nicknamed Pinky.
Hey, everybody's got their own little thing.
Got to have a little bit of fun with it. Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss for strike one. That one looked like it was in the dirt right there. Had a lot of break on it going. A lot of sinking on.
A lot of tail, yeah.
There you go. Thank you. That's the word I
believe that would be a one seam that he just threw. That's what he throws. It's a variation of a two seam in a sinker. Yeah. It's got great movement.
It does. We saw that up here just now. Slavin saw it firsthand. Pitch popped up. Will it be out of play? It will be out of play. What's it going to hit? Let's hit.
No car, I don't think.
That's always the goal. If you hit it foul, just don't hit a car. Funniest one I ever saw was at Clinton where there was a car driving down where third base side is, and it bounced and hit the driver's side door with it. Didn't do any damage, and the driver got out and just started laughing and threw the ball back in. Time called at the last second by Slavin.
Not a bad decision as a hitter.
I'll say that.
If you can get away with it, then that's definitely throws off the pitcher, which is an advantage.
I was going to say, that one was a very late time call. Don't know if I would have granted it, but that was a good call, like you said.
Yeah. I mean, when you get it, it's definitely a good thing.
Pitch, foul back and out of play. Hear a bunch of heads being called, so it's going to go near some of the fans that are standing out there. Probably still taking money from people coming into the game.
Yes.
I like the location of this field, too. You got a great view, especially in the fall when you got the colors in the outfield.
Yes.
Right now, not too many colors considering what month it is, but it's still a great view out here.
Yeah, you can see a pretty good ways away here.
One of my favorite signs is Sonic right in dead center field.
Yeah. We have Sonic, Arby's, American flag.
The runner's going.
Luke Langford with the pick. Morgan Clark throws it.
Oh, he gets away. I don't give that error to Clark on that one. I'll give that to the second base.
Yes, sir.
That was a great pitch or a great throw right there by Clark.
That'd be an error on Alex Bond. Yes.
And Lou, he knew that he had a feeling that was going to happen.
Yes. Because
he stepped off like he was going to try to pick him off at first. And Harrison took off right before he did the step off. Or that would have been even closer than it actually was. Should have been out with that catch.
Yes.
Just a little bit of a bad break. 0-2 count.
Runner on second.
The pitch to Slavin high for ball one. 1-2 count here at top of the third. 5-0 your score. Mavericks scoring all five in the first inning.
Not a bad spot considering the count there. He may be setting up something else here.
What would you call in this situation?
Knowing Luke, I'd probably call it change up low away. See if we can spike it in the dirt and get him to chase.
I like the little action right there between your shortstop and your second baseman trying to get Harrison to lean one way or the other.
We work quite a bit in the offseason on our first and third and our bunt coverages, runners on base, pickoff moves. That's another thing. Coach Tanner Williams, he's definitely helped us out with that.
And a swing and a miss for strike three to end the inning. So, once again, Shelton gets on and does not score, leaving the score still 5-0. No runs on no hits, one error, and one left.
We've got a lot of students out here today, which is never a complaint. I know the past couple years we haven't had very many students come out to support the baseball. Just weird season time. Everything's already gone through. Maybe people are wore out, I don't know. But a lot of young fans here today, a lot of families. No complaints.
We had a very good crowd on Monday night, too. So that's something that Coach Stacy said after the game in our interview. He credited how baseball is doing in Anderson County as a whole. You got crowds showing up that have never shown up before.
Yes.
And it's energizing both all teams.
Yeah, we're really trying to get the community involved with our sport, and not only with baseball, but we just try to get our community involved with all sports, football. I know we have tons of people that come for football, especially when it's Clinton against Anderson County, whether it's at Clinton or Anderson County. I know we're really close. We're right across the bridge from each other, essentially.
And
so we've got a lot of people will come out to support both teams. So that always makes the game more interesting as a player, as a fan.
As a teacher and an alumni for both, it does the same.
Yeah.
And in all sports, it's almost standing room only.
Yes.
No matter what field you're at, no matter what sport it is.
Yeah.
And that's always good to see. And it's in all good spirits.
Yes, there's
a little chippiness that happens, which happens everywhere.
Well, that just comes with rivalry. I mean,
like yesterday, or Monday, when Garrett got tossed, Coach Stacy stopped, there was a warning to both sides, and you and I both agreed on that warning.
Yes.
Just to make sure everyone's in their same spot.
Yes. Not batting for Anderson County, Morgan Clark.
He's made it to base four times in the last two games.
Yeah, he's definitely been producing very well. Swinging on the first pitch for a foul ball.
Once again, I'll say it every time he comes up, I'm a proud teacher. Every time I see Morgan, I wish him well. Maybe not as much because I'm a Clinton grad when I'm calling these games, but I still want him to do well against every team that he plays.
From a personal
aspect, yes.
Yes, sir.
0-1 count from Duggins. Duggins and Jace, Mac.
Ball just a little bit high.
Probably right around the letters on that one.
Yeah.
That was a good location.
That call could have gone either way.
Very good location for that one.
Yes. Morgan Clark staying relaxed in the box here.
Maybe he'll laugh a little bit like he did on Monday.
Oh, where's one to the tailbone, it appears. Low back.
He won't be laughing with that hit, but he will be laughing that he got on base.
Not happy about it, but I know for a fact Morgan Clark understands that's just part of the risk you make when you get in the box. So Trent Strickland coming up, as mentioned previously, great guy. I was talking about him the other day. He's great, great, great young man. He's a great friend, great athlete.
A great friend, great athlete, great teammate.
Yes,
Morgan
for sure.
Walked out of his own shoes going to first base. So we're going to have to call a time as he tries to put on his cleats again. I'm going to have to give him some trouble for that one in class. Ask him, what did you do to walk out of your cleats going to first?
It was only a double knot, Coach, not a triple knot.
Maybe we should put some Velcro across of it next time.
Yeah, I don't know how much he'd like that one. He's not a fan of Velcro.
The pitch.
Oh,
that was
another
close
pitch too.
I actually thought that might have come close to hitting.
I thought I was going to nip him there.
You and I both. We saw it at the same time. Clark taking the lead at first. The pitch to Wilkerson lined, and it's not Wilkerson. That's Strickland.
Strickland.
And foul. Wilkerson wears the number that I wore every time I play of 10. I should know that by now.
Hey, it's no biggie. I'm sure neither of them will be upset by that. I mean, we all make mistakes. No worries, though. Trent Strickland in there, 1-1 count. Morgan Clark on first base.
A little bit low and away for that one for ball two. Clark dancing around a little bit. I think he wants to take off, but he's just waiting on that call.
I was going to say waiting for Coach to give him permission. Or waiting for a better opportunity. Back.
I like the way you call that one.
A little bit of a scream here from me.
You're
still not used to the booth action.
But you're having fun up here.
You can
yell a little bit and stuff like that, too.
I don't want to blast anybody's ears out.
No, we got control of the volume up here. It's fine. 2-1 count.
Getting a little bit generous over there.
Garrett Lee trying to hold him on. Here's the pitch. Low and away. Chase Mack looked like he was going to try for the back pick, but
he definitely considered it. Got him
back. I've seen Mac do several of those back picks. He just – and I once again, I want to say the music up here is some of the best I've heard to have some fun with it.
Yes, sir.
Want to give a big shout-out to that being played every time something happens. 3-1 count, the pitch.
Close
low
pitch.
For ball four. Morgan did, Morgan kind of thought that was a strike because he started going back to first.
Time called by the Clinton Dragons here. A little bit of a mound visit here. We'll see what happens.
Who comes up?
Yes, sir.
Are they going to warm up? Are they going to leave him on there? I think they're going to try to leave him in.
Try and get as much as they can out of him.
As if I'm not, they haven't signaled anybody, and I don't see anybody coming in the infield that would actually be able to, that would want or could relieve right now for him. I kind of know who the reliever would be, but I'm waiting to see if it actually happens or not. So we got runners on first and second. Nobody out here in the bottom of the third inning. It's the second mound visit for Coach Stacy. They are going to make a change. Isaiah Slavin's going to come in to pitch for the Dragons now, and they're going to send Sam Duggins out to right field. They're just going to switch them places right there. Isaiah Slavin, I've got his stats that I'll pull up real quick.
I was going to say, I do not have those.
I have Isaiah's. I just got to find them again. I'll pull them up on my other computer instead of pulling them up on the screen. It may take just a minute.
I can always grab my phone. Now probably wouldn't be a bad time for me to give Lane Fletcher a text,
see if we can get Lane up here.
Yeah, exactly. See if we can get Fletcher up here for a little bit of conversation. Or
talk about being
injury.
A senior, talk about what he's looking forward to, like in this game and in other games.
Let's see. I may have to text the coach, actually.
That's fine. Isaiah
Hopefully
Slavin.
I'm not interrupting.
Making his sixth appearance, he's got a 1.00 ERA, 14 innings pitched, 22 strikeouts to 6 walks.
That's impressive.
It's about a 3-1, almost a 4-1 walk to strikeout ratio.
For this early in the season, that's phenomenal.
Rephrase, strikeout to walk ratio.
Yes.
I said it the wrong way around, but
I understood what you meant.
Yeah, exactly. So, and Slavin came in relief in that 6-4 win on Monday night. Once again, talk about this week also. You guys have several more games along with Clinton the rest of this week.
Yes, sir.
We want to make sure that everyone can get out to each of the games because we want to see crowds at both of these schools.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
I know the Dragons on Thursday night, tomorrow night, will be playing David Crockett at 8 o'clock. Friday, they will be playing Sevier County in the alumni night. They want all the alumni to get out there, and if any alumni are listening, we want you to join me in the booth and help us call some
yes.
of this game because that would be fun.
I mean, I like to come back and watch these. I mean, not only because I'm talking, but even before that, I was watching a game, I believe, from maybe 2 years ago.
It was like last year. Last year's the first year we did this for baseball.
I was
going to
say, I know it was one of your very early videos, and I enjoyed watching it. I mean,
it's
great to review because you not only for people who may not be able to attend the game or may just – for whatever reason they have. It's also good for coaches and players to – you can go back and you can review on yourself. You can see improvement. You can see what you need to work on for both sides.
Both sides.
And it's very – it's called very very equally. I know I can be a little bit biased at times.
I'm still a little early here. We all can.
I'm still trying to learn.
Well, you're doing a phenomenal job. We got Isaiah Slavin on the mound now, making the first pitch of the game for him. It's going to be low and inside for ball one. Who's up to bat again?
I was going to say we have Alex Bond, the starting pitcher for Monday night for the first game of the Clinton Maverick series here. So we've got a runner on second and third, which appears to be Morgan Clark and Trent Strickland.
Runners on inside for ball two. It's actually runners on
first and second. My bad.
We each, like you said, you caught me on a mistake earlier, so we got to get each, we got to have each other's back when we're up here. 2-0 count now. Slavin a little bit inside for both of his first two pitches. Trying to back Strickland off the plate just a little bit more. The 2-0 pitch. Called a little bit low. That was close.
Very close. That pitch definitely could have gone either way there. I mean, he's hanging in there. We got 3 balls, but that could very easily have been a 2-1 count right there.
3-0 count. This one should be right down the middle.
Called strike right there.
That was on the outside corner. I can hear some of the fans kind of arguing that call.
A little bit of disapproval there, but – at the end of the day, what the umpire calls is what the game is played.
Exactly.
We all make mistakes, and he might have thought that was better than what it was. But that's all right.
Next one fouled out. I think he tried to take off a couple of your on-deck batter's head right there with that one.
I mean, I know we had Easton Beatty on deck there maybe moving out of the way, Aiden Bond ducking, but Coach Williams standing there strong. He ain't scared of nothing. takes a hurricane to blow that guy over.
We'll see. Let's hope we don't get one of those today.
I don't think we will. Considering how far we are off the coast.
Ground ball foul down the third baseline.
Runner still on second and first. Full count here for Slavin. And is that who's on the mound?
It is who's on the mound.
I'm learning y'all's names.
And just remember, the runners at first and second are credited to Sam Duggins, the starting
pitcher.
Full count, no outs. Popped him up. It's going to go towards Sam Duggins, actually, who it goes over his head. He throws it in.
A little bit of a backup on the baseline here, but everybody gets back to a desired location on a base.
Yeah, so that's a single on the mound. And we'll introduce our guest during the break. I'll let you two talk during the middle of the infield. We'll have our guest up here, unless he wants to.
That's a sophomore. Max Giles in here.
I've talked to Max a couple times. I did an interview with him actually recently. He did a really good job. He's one of the better ones that I've talked to recently. So let's see. That is another single. So you got runners on. Oh, yeah. Bases loaded now with nobody out here in the bottom of the third inning.
Easton Beatty back up to bat.
Pitch from Slavin's going to be popped up.
Swinging.
Down the first baseline. Garrett Lee chasing it.
Will he get there?
No, he will not. Lands in the
ball
bullpen.
Ball in the bullpen. Speaking of the bullpen, looking down there, we have, I believe, Gary Terry from what it looks like up here.
I do see Gary Terry. It looks like we see there's several.
I think there's a sport coach. I can't quite tell from up here, but always great to see admin at our games.
We got three or four coaches on – or three or four admin
coaches
and alumni out there.
I believe Coach Lambert from football's here.
Looks like it.
Always here to support. Very close call there. That ball could have also been called.
That one was very close.
Called a strike as well.
Got a 1-1 count now, if I'm not mistaken.
It's a competitive pitch.
Yeah, 1-1 count, no outs. Pitch from Slavin. Inside, but called strike one.
Called strike. That ball had great tail on it.
That one did. I wasn't sure, and I know Strickland tried to jump out of the way on that one. Or not Strickland. Beatty tried to jump out of the way on that one. So, you got 1-2 count.
He did.
That was a nice little break for that strike three call.
First out of the inning, strikeout by, I believe, Isaiah Slavin.
That was Isaiah Slavin. That's his 23rd strikeout of the season.
Here we go. Gavin Hill with Lane Fletcher's walk-up song, I believe.
And Gavin Hill reached on an error in the first inning. Bases loaded, one out. Isaiah Slavin at the mound. First pitch from Slavin. Curved around, just missing. He is nipping that corner every time, but just a little too far.
Competitive pitch right there.
Be a hard one to lay off for anybody.
For
me. The 1-0 pitch popped up.
Gavin Hill pops up.
Mac coming back
to go
for
foul.
Got it aimed, so you can see Mac making the catch in foul territory. Nice little play out there by the catcher. Once again, we have two very competitive catchers.
Yes.
Very good catchers out here for both sides.
Luke Langford coming up to bat for a second AB.
He struck out in his first at
bat. Yes, he did. He struck out first AB.
In the bottom of the first inning for the third out. Let's hope he doesn't do that in this inning. Want to make this a little bit more competitive for this at bat for him. First pitch right down the middle for strike one.
Yes, sir.
A 1 count, two outs here in the bottom of the third inning. Pitch from Slavin. Foul. I think he's trying to take out some of the Dragons on that one. Where did that one go?
I believe that ball went right towards the Dragon bullpen based on my little bit of a lean as much as I can get up here in the press box.
And as you can tell from our camera angle as well.
Might have bounced around and maybe hit somebody parked down there. Hopefully not.
Hopefully not. So here's the 0-2 pitch.
Luke Langford battling it off again towards people's cars.
Thankfully, my car's not parked out there this time. I don't know where yours is. Mine's not.
Luckily, I'm parked way up the parking lot. I'm way in the back.
I think
so.
You and I are both up there. So
I've got no worries today.
0-2 count, two outs. Here's the pitch from Slavin.
Luke Langford staying competitive in that box.
Got to give him credit. He's keeping this at-bat alive. He's doing a lot better than he did in that first at-bat.
Yes.
Langford wearing number 20. Once again, I love these black and white uniforms for the Mavs. One, because it's easier for me to read the numbers.
Definitely.
0-2 pitch. Swing and a miss.
Ooh.
Foul tip for strike three to end the inning. That's back-to-back strikeouts for Langford to end the first and the third inning. So Isaiah Slavin coming in with bases loaded and able to give no runs out. We're going to take a quick break. You are listening to Clinton Dragon and Anderson County Maverick Baseball.
Doing our best here.
Welcome back to Clinton Dragon and Anderson County Maverick Baseball. Here in the top of the fourth inning, your score 5-0. And, of course, I've been looking at this the wrong way the whole time. I gave all five runs to Clinton, which is actually 5-0 Anderson County. So I just went and fixed that. That was my mistake because I was still thinking we were at Clinton.
Hey, I mean, between you're doing the Clinton, you're doing the charts over here, trying to give me directions.
Exactly.
You're multitasking for sure.
We're all having fun. So leading off for the Dragons.
Garrett Lee.
Garrett, the Giant Lee, as we nicknamed him earlier this year. First pitch to Lee.
Swing and a miss.
Swung out of his shoes on that one for strike one. Garrett Lee, been close on several times this season with some very deep balls, just not far enough. The 0-1 pitch to Lee.
Another swing and a miss. Getting a little big there. Appears maybe pulled his head off a little bit. See if he'll shorten up here. Assuming he gets a nice competitive pitch. Never know what you're going to see here, though.
Langford doing a phenomenal job through three innings so far for the Mavericks. The pitch to Lee. Little high. Probably a little high,
a little outside.
Yeah, it's probably about letter high.
Letter to chin high, I'd say.
Your cat, Ty Wilson, not really arguing that one either. Just threw it right back. The pitch. Ground ball. Short. Third. Gets through the six hole. Or through the five hole for that one. Lee rounding first, but gets back in time. And we actually have a special guest. We're going to let you talk to the special. We're going to do this one in between innings. We'll talk to the special guest about how his season went prior to Monday and what he's looking forward to and what with your team for the rest of the season. May pull him up here in just a second. We want to see how this one goes. We got a runner at first with nobody out. First pitch.
Ball outside.
Lee on first. And you've got Jackson Webb, the designated hitter, up to bat. Jackson Webb, a sophomore for the Dragons. Webb getting better every game. Stood in there and took a pitch on the inside corner for strike one.
Very nice placement by that pitch by Luke Langford there. The ball had quite a bit of movement there. I think
it moved three different directions on that pitch.
I wouldn't be surprised. We know that Luke Langford doesn't have the strongest velo, but he definitely does have great movement on all of his pitches, which is one of his great attributes.
Checking Lee at first. 1-1 pitch. Swing and a miss for strike two. Yeah, it's a great inning so far. It's a great game so far for Langford. Great game for all the Mavericks so far. After batting around in the first inning, slow second inning, had a decent third inning until Slavin came in. Pops him up,
balls
going
up
towards third base. Third base coming in, catches it while standing on third base for the first out of the inning.
One out. Made by Reese Wilkerson.
Nice play, Reese Wilkerson. As J.P. Robbins comes up to bat next.
And did you say he was the freshman?
He is a freshman. So we had a sophomore just now.
Filling in some big shoes.
And now we have a sophomore fly out to third. Now we have a freshman coming up to bat for the Dragons. JP popped out to the first baseman in his first at-bat. First pitch to Robbins. Foul tip and back to the backstop for strike one. Once again, Dragon starting two underclassmen today. I'll count underclassmen as players below a junior. But JP, you can't tell when he comes out there to practice or anything that he is a freshman. He's got the mindset. He just wants to get better no matter what he does. I'll call him by his nickname if he earns it right here. Throwback, Garrett Lee gets back. All right. So I'll call him by his nickname on this pitch, or I'll just call him right now. Let's see how Jumbo does on this one. Don't know how he got the nickname Jumbo, but Slavin and a few of the seniors have given him that nickname, and he's playing to his potential. 0-1 count, one out. Lee at first, pitched it. He pops him up going towards shortstop. The Bond brothers getting behind it. Shortstop catches it. Alex Bond on the catch for out number two. Alex Duggins coming up to bat next for the Dragons.
Still runner on first here for the Dragons. Two outs.
Alex Duggins, a junior on the team. His brother Sam, the senior, was the starting pitcher tonight. Duggins, the starting third baseman. The pitch to Duggins.
Inside.
Just a bit inside for that one.
Just a bit inside. A little bit nippy on the knees there.
Yeah, wasn't sure. Wasn't quite close enough to hit him like a couple of the pitches we saw from his brother. Let's see how Langford does on this pitch. 1-0 count. Pitches back. Lee gets back. Lee, if I'm not mistaken, Lee has four stolen bases on the season. One oh count. Two outs. Top of the fourth inning. 5-0 your score. The Mavericks lead the Dragons 5-0. Strike to make it an even 1-1 count. So you got a 1-1 count, two outs. Lee at first. Alex Duggins up to bat. Next pitch, popped down the first baseline and out of play. So you got a 1-2 count now with two outs. Once again, beautiful day for baseball here at Merle Albright Field. Langford toeing the mound. Checks Lee at first from the stretch. Lined up over the second baseman's head. Right fielder coming in, calling him off. Makes the third out of the inning. So no runs, no hits, no errors. One left midway through the fourth. Your score, 5-0, the Mavericks. And we're going to bring in Lane Fletcher here. Let Lane pick up the headset. You might have to help him with the headset real quick. So, Lane, one thing we want – welcome into Draymond. One thing we want to say is great job. We're proud of you from yesterday. We all were praying for you. I'm glad you're out here. Tell us a little bit about your career here at Anderson County so far.
Yeah, I mean, it's been great. Nothing short of amazing. We got a great staff, great teammates. We're a family up here. I've loved every minute of it.
You're here. I know you suffered what happened yesterday. What did it mean to see both teams surrounding you and making you – and checking on you all day today?
It was awesome. I mean – obviously, freak accident, nothing we can do about it. But, you know, having my team there and having the Dragons back behind me, I mean, we're a rivalry, but at the end, we're a family.
Yeah, right. This is a family. This is a family in Clinton and a family in Anderson County. What have you seen from your players, from your teammates today?
Today, I mean, obviously we had a good first inning. We slowed down. We're not being as aggressive at the plate as I wish we would be. I don't know. We still got a few more innings to go. I'd like to see what we can do.
What are you looking forward to this inning? You're back near the top of the order. I see you are actually at the top of the order. What do you want to see in this inning?
I don't know. We got to get this first guy on base and see what we can do, pushing him, get him around.
All right, I'll let
pass
you
the bat.
You can help me call this inning. If you want to sit down right there, you can help me call this inning and see how it goes. Once again, this is Lane Fletcher, a senior for the Anderson County Mavericks, as Isaiah Slavin is still the pitcher. And who's up to bat for you all?
Got Aiden Bond, leadoff batter, shortstop.
I know you're a senior along with Aiden. What does it mean having such a strong bond with your team?
Yeah, I mean, ever since even before high school, I've been playing with these guys and building the friendships and the memories that we have, it comes great with playing again or playing with them.
Aiden swinging a little bit late on that pitch for strike two. And I know you know a lot of the seniors over at Clinton as well. So
I do.
You can see how much family it meant to you yesterday as well. Here's the 0-2 pitch to Bond. Swing and a miss for strike three. That's 23 strikeouts on the year for Isaiah Slavin. And the first out in the top of the fourth, or bottom of the fourth inning.
Starting to pitch us backwards.
Talk about Reese. What does he mean to your all's team?
I mean, he was a big pickup for us, you know, especially coming from Clinton. It's a big move for him, and I think he's been a good addition to our lineup.
First pitch to Reese. A lot of movement on that pitch for the strike.
Starting the inning with a lot of curveballs.
I know you're. What would you be looking for up here? How would you approach this one after seeing that last at bat?
Coming from a two-hole batter and late in the game and him seeing what we can do, I would definitely be throwing a lot of off-speed pitches.
Ground ball to shortstop. Robbins on the throw. They call him in time. That was a bang-bang play, but a good throw from the shortstop, J.P. Robbins, or Jumbo as they call him. Talk about Ty Wilson.
He's been swinging it pretty well for us this year. He started off pretty hot. I don't know, the last few games he's been kind of mediocre at the plate, but I'm ready for him to get back into it. He's been pretty good for us.
Two outs, first pitch to Ty, a little bit high for ball one.
I believe that's the first fastball of the inning.
I believe so. You would be able to call that one faster than I would, but so we got a 1-0 count if I can get my scoring right on my chart.
Curveball just missed.
You can hear a little bit of fans not really liking some of those calls, but up here, those are some. They're calling it about even on both sides.
Yeah, he looks pretty good behind the plate.
So you got a foul.
Definitely
back there.
A lot better than we've seen.
Oh, a lot better than seen on either side. So we're doing. This is a great one. Great game so far. You got Morgan Clark on deck. I've been complimenting him because he's actually one of my students as well. Morgan, one of the best people I've met.
Absolutely, I love him.
Yeah, I think that one was just a bit inside. I don't know if he was looking for some chin music or not on that pitch, making it 3-1 count. Two outs here, bottom of the fourth inning. Pitch from Slavin. Popped him up. It's being called by the second baseman, Braden Hensley, who makes the third out of the inning. So a 1-2-3 inning for Isaiah Slavin. No runs, no hits, no errors, no one left. So now we're going to talk about this one. What does it mean playing in this rivalry? What does this mean to you?
This is a big game. We always love going to each other's fields and playing each other. It's a big game for us every year. I mean, we always play a tight game with them. A lot of runs are scored. We've got to play hard. I mean, nothing's going to be easy. It's a fun game to play, and I love watching it. I mean, I wish I could be out there, but, you know, getting to be a part of it, getting to be in the dugout, and being a part of this team, it means a lot.
And I want you to talk about Coach Boynton, how he's letting you all help me out up here, or he's letting us up here. What do you want to say to Coach Boynton and the rest of your staff?
I don't have words for our staff. They are absolutely amazing. Bringing on Coach Williams this year has been great for us, not having a pitching coach last year. I mean, he's worked with our pitchers a lot, and Coach Lefford working with our hitters, and Coach B leading this team. I mean, ever since he became head coach, I mean, this program has turned around, and it's a great move.
It was a great move. I've met Coach Boynton for the last couple of years. He's made an impact on me personally, and I respect him. Talk about these uniforms. I've been complimenting these uniforms all day. I love the black, white, and now I see it's actually a gray silver trim. These uniforms look great, especially at this field.
I mean, I like all our uniforms. I mean, I'd have to say, honestly, probably the black is probably my least favorite, only because, I don't know, it's just a T-shirt. It's just a preference for me, but I don't know. I love all our uniforms. I think they look pretty good.
They look great on this field. And one other thing I gave a compliment of on this field is the Mavs logo out in right center.
They just got that done in the offseason.
So we're getting ready to start the bottom of the fifth. If you want to stay up here and call one more, you can. If not, you can give it back to Mo.
I'll give it off to him.
So go ahead and take the headset from him, Mo. I know it's a little bit harder for him to try to get this headset off right now. But once again, we want to thank Lane Fletcher. Did a phenomenal job helping us out. I'm glad he's doing well. I hope that's for a speedy recovery. I want to see you back in district play, if not even sooner.
Shout out to Big Red on the mic.
So now we got a nickname for when I see him.
Big Red. Yes, sir. Big Red. All right, here we are.
Up to bat.
Top
number
of the
18. Eight. Actually, we got a pinch hitter right now. Hayden Allen, the senior from the Dragons, making his first at bat of the night.
Top of the fifth inning here.
Top of the fifth. He is taking the place of Alex Duggins.
Luke Lankford, first pitch was a ball. A little bit low there on number 18 here.
Hayden Allen. I've known his family years. Hayden Allen is one of the best he's, unlike most of them, he's one of the best people you'll meet. Very respectful. Loves to learn stuff. On there, and 1-1 count now after he got called for strike one. The pitch. Ooh, if he would have ducked out of that one, that might have hit him, but it's going to be a ball nonetheless. Looked like that was going to hit him right in the knuckles if he wouldn't have moved out of the way. 2-1 count. Swing
Luke,
and miss.
Luke Langer with finding a way to get back to an even count here.
That's all. That's
a little
all.
Bit of pressure on both sides here.
That's always a good thing. If you can work from being behind to even, yes. It gives you a little bit of the momentum.
Yes, yes, definitely. Strike three. A little bit of anger there from
Allen.
From Allen there. Not exactly his goal there, but.
So actually, Hayden Allen took. Okay, Dallas Beat. That is Dallas Beat's up to bat next. I had. Okay, because Duggins was the third out of the inning. That's where I messed up. So he took the place of Braden Hensley. So now Dallas
Luke
Beat's
Langford
the ninth batter.
Fastball in there for a strike.
So, you got an 0-1 count as soon as my scoreboard decides to refresh to show everybody. Swing and a miss for strike two. No balls, two strikes here at the bottom, or the top of the fifth inning at the bottom of the order. The ninth batter, the left fielder, Dallas Beats. Dallas Beats, a junior for the Dragons. The 0-2 pitch. Low.
In the dirt.
Trying to get him to chase, but not that far. Just a little bit higher, he might have gone after that one. Coach Boyden, I got some real confidence in Langford tonight. Langford's pitching a phenomenal game.
Yes.
Swing
strike
and miss
three
for
right
strike
there.
Three. That is
two outs for the
strikeout
inning.
Number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, maybe 7 strikeouts tonight for Langford.
Congratulations to Luke Langford on that.
As Chase
Mack. That's big.
Jason
especially
Matt
with this competition
up.
And pressure.
Matt comes up to bat. He is 1-for-2 on the day with a single. Top of the order for the Dragons.
With a little bit of lefty-on-lefty action here.
What is that like when you have to go up against a lefty-on-lefty or righty-on-righty for that matter?
Righty-on-righty, I'd say, isn't near as big of a deal than a lefty-on-lefty, especially in high school sports or any sport in general or level of this sport. Lefty-on-lefty, especially in high school, is just something you don't see quite as often. There's definitely majority of players are right-handed, so when you get a left-handed pitcher crossed with a left-handed hitter, I mean, it's just something that not everybody sees all the time.
1-0 pitch hits the outside corner for strike one.
I mean, I feel like left-handers are usually accustomed to seeing the fastball break away from them because of a right-handed pitcher, whereas now the ball is breaking in on them as an off-speed but coming in quicker.
Lined over the second baseman's head.
Nice little bloop shot. Yeah, nice way to get on base for the team. Get them started up here, hopefully.
That's his second hit of the day. Both of them were bloop singles. First in the top of the first, second one here in the fifth inning. Now we got Harrison Shelton, the only Dragon in this season to have a home run as courtesy runner Jackson Barrett comes on for the Dragons. Jackson Barrett has 4 stolen bases on the night or on the season so far. Wayne, mark it right in my scorebook. As Harrison Chug comes up with Pinky to see if he
Pinky.
Can. Pinky?
Oh,
yeah, Pinky.
Oh, boy.
Oh, look. See if he wants, or he, as he calls it, Harry 14.
Harry 14.
So here's the pitch. He bangs one all the way right field, backing up to the warning track, to the
ball
wall,
mate.
Off
ball
the
ball.
Wall. One run, turning third. Harrison turning to third, trying to get a triple. One run is in, and Harrison makes it for a triple. Big time triple right there. Harrison Shelton to get the first run on the boards for the Dragons.
That was a great hit there for the Dragons, especially under that kind of pressure. Two outs, you're down in the game. Two strikeouts prior to you. So that's definitely a competitive player right there.
Yeah, I guess Pinky did work for him
on
that one.
Pinky did the job.
He's going to give me some trouble for that one for price, but we're going to say it anyway. So here comes Isaiah.
It can't be an insult whenever you have something like that happen, though, with it.
No, it
exactly.
can't be.
Exactly. It's a compliment.
Here's the pitch. Slavin knocks
another one
about the same spot, but the left fielder or right fielder is waiting on it. Makes the third
Easton
out of
the
inning.
With the third out of the inning.
Makes up for that last one, which he couldn't tell if it was going to be off the wall or not. That was a nice little drive right there.
Yeah, that ball just kept carrying. I mean, there's not much wind here today, but the wind is favoring right side of the field, so that could have helped, but that ball was hit square from the start. So,
yeah, so one run on one hit, no errors, one man left. Midway through the fifth, your score 5-1. The Mavericks lead your Clinton Dragons. And I know you've been having fun. What have you thought about your first couple broadcasts up here?
I mean, I've had a great time. Definitely have enjoyed it. I mean, I'm not the smoothest out here. Can't say I could be, though, from my limited experience. But you do a very good job of, before I even get on here. You explain to me how everything works. I mean, everything you've had set up from your systems and organization is very well done.
Thanks.
I enjoy it. I also enjoy how you call a very even game. You do your best to keep a very level, very –
And I'll give you the same credit. I know you play for the Mavericks. I'm a Clinton grad, but we both are trying to call it as even
yeah,
as
I mean,
we can.
Yeah, I mean, I know I favor Anderson County a little bit. I feel like if I had a little bit more knowledge about the Dragons and if I would have done a little bit more research on them, then I definitely could have called this more fair.
It's the same way for me. I don't know all the Maverick players like you do. I know mainly Morgan Clark, who is one of mine, and I know
yes,
Tyson
sir.
Bradley, who's another one of my
yes,
students.
Yes, sir.
Other than that, I'm learning them as well, and that's why you can favor
yeah.
them a little bit. I'll favor the Dragons a little bit, but we won a great game either way.
Oh, yes, for sure.
And leading off, of course.
Leading off, Morgan Clark.
He has
Sticks. Known by the team. College commit, as previously stated.
And he has made it on base 5 consecutive at-bats. I am not trying to give the broadcaster jinx. I am just speaking the truth with him. He is one of the best just at the plate overall.
Yes, he's very very calm, very confident, and I think that has a lot to do with how he performs.
First pitch, a lot of tail on it, but not quite enough.
A little bit. It appeared to me as a little bit of a hanging off speed. Maybe just didn't quite get through it, or maybe he intentionally wanted to leave it up there a little bit, see if he could get Clark to chase on it, maybe pop it up. Second pitch, right in there though for a strike with some great tail on there.
Yeah, but. He's got the curve going both directions
yes,
right now.
Yes, he does. And that's a huge advantage for a left-handed pitcher.
Slavin moving a little bit quickly, too. He's doing I'm not going to call it quite a quick pitch, but he's going fast through his progression to get to the next pitch.
Hey, who knows? Maybe he's got just a little bit of jitters. I say it all the time, but oh.
Morgan pops it up. Going
into the Bermuda Triangle of right field.
It's going to land.
Gets down. It is fair ball.
And he's going to throw it to second. Will
second,
he make it in time?
And he is there.
He is in
for
time.
For a double.
That is a double. Sam Duggan's trying to catch it. He was out. He was in foul territory and knocked it fair.
It looks like he may have slipped.
He did slip just
gonna
a
say,
little bit.
I know it's a little bit slick out there, but nothing too terrible. But that's also part of the game. I mean, it goes both ways. Both sides are playing in the same spot, so.
Trent Strickland, 1-for-1 on the night with a single and a walk. And as I called it in the last one, Morgan Clark now 6 for his last 6 getting on base, either via hit,
walk,
some way. He has gotten on base his last 6
scratched
at-bats.
And clawed onto the base.
Outside for ball one to Trent Strickland. Once again, Trent Strickland, 1-for-1 on the night with a single and a walk. Slavin slowing down just a little bit. Checks the runner at second. Curved.
Called strike right there.
There's
excellent placement there by the pitcher.
And there's that little tail that we've seen on both going both directions.
It almost looks like it might not be a curveball, but it might be a cutter maybe.
It could.
I mean, it's got just enough movement to squeeze its way into the strike zone.
Strickland right on that one right off the edge of the bat of Strickland. He timed that one up fairly well. It was just a little bit too far. Outside when he hit it. And once again, this is a beautiful day. Nice little breeze outside for baseball here at Merle Albright Field.
Morgan Clark leaving early. Morgan Clark making it there due to him.
A
missed
throwing
throw.
Error.
Clark going home.
And he's going to make
and
it
Clark
home with
makes
no
it in
throw.
Standing.
Nice little run right there, Morgan Clark. Nice base running on that one.
Good heads-up play there by Morgan Clark, or heads-up base running, I should say.
He gets the run. He gets the run back that they gave up in the top of the fifth inning.
Trent Strickland still.
2-2 count.
2-2 count. No outs. No runners on. And he puts the ball in play towards shortstop.
Picked up by Hensley. Looked like make it in time on the infield single. And I see Clark's going nuts over there for that one. He hadn't even made it back into the dugout yet.
Clark is definitely high on life right now. I tell you what. He's excited and he's happy to be here, I guarantee it.
I know I'll hear about that one tomorrow.
I'm sure you will. Alex Bond now coming in for the Anderson County Mavericks.
Alex Bond has been on base both at bats and scored one run tonight.
Ball may get down.
It does.
Foul ball down.
A lot of foul territory here.
Yes.
At the field. So there's a lot of areas where it can go and they can catch it. Unlike some of the sections over at Clinton where it is ruled dead if it hits certain areas.
Yeah, a little more closed off. But, I mean, that's just the difference ballpark to ballpark.
Yeah, also, I like the dimensions out here. 316 to right, 346 right center, 370 to dead center.
346 to left and 314 down the left field line.
As this one is fouled back by Aiden Bond. Glad to see Aiden still getting to play this season after
– Alex.
Or Alex. Thank you. I get the Bond mixed up.
Alex, the younger one, a little bit taller.
The pitcher from yesterday.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Aiden wearing number 3, Alex wearing number 1. That'll make it easier, I'm telling myself in my head as well. I know he likes playing with his brother one last season.
For sure, for sure.
Rips one.
Good swing. Might be a little bit too high.
Picked up by Harrison Shelton, who holds the runner at first for the first out of the inning. So an F8 if you are scoring that at home.
Number 5, Easton Beatty.
Easton Beatty coming up for the Anderson County Mavericks now.
He is 0-for-2 today with a ground out to the pitcher and a strikeout.
With a little bit of difficulty. A little bit of difficulty with the bat. Made a couple plays in the outfield, I know. So we'll see. He's definitely swinging to hit to Arby's right now, if y'all can see that.
Yeah.
A little ways out there.
You can see the Arby's sign. You can also see the Taco Bell sign.
He's swinging for Arby's with that one. We'll see. Hopefully he'll simmer down here, and hopefully he'll find a nice base hit. That'd be great for the team.
Strickland attempting for third. Shelton firing it into third. Gets it there, and he's out, and they're going to call him safe.
Safe.
He got there in time, but he made it underneath the tag. Nice little base running right there to get a runner at third with a 1-1 count now.
I wouldn't be surprised here if we see a bunt from the Mavericks. See if we can get another run in here.
So safety squeeze?
Yes, sir.
1-1 count. Pitch from Slavin, a little outside for ball 2. That's not usually a throw I see from Mac. Mac's usually really good about hitting his players, but I think the nerves are getting to him all right now.
Yes, yes. Yep. Tempted bunt. Pulled back in time.
I was wondering if
that was
he did.
A little close.
That was close. I was wondering if he did. I wasn't going to say anything until I saw the call from the umpire. 3-1 count, 1 out, 6-1 your score. Mavericks lead your Clinton Dragons. The 3-1 pitch from Slavin. Curves it across the outside corner for strike 2. I'll let you talk about that pitch.
I was going to say, that ball had some great movement on it. That ball started, I would say, can't see the white line anymore, but I'd say that ball started probably on the white line of the left-handed batter's box and broke in to get that back corner of the plate.
The payoff pitch, foul down the right field line.
Easton Beatty battling in there. Looking not to go down without a fight, looking to hopefully get on and potentially score Trent Strickland that's made it around to third base.
I think Morgan Clark's trying to show off that hair he has. He's trying to get a little modeling deal.
Trying to show off a little bit of the flow. Easton Beatty's still battling in there.
That one wouldn't have quite hit us. That one would have gone just one row over from us.
Yes, sir.
I think he's trying to aim for everybody but forward right now. He needs to hit that direction instead.
Yes, sir.
Still a full count pitch with 1 out, runner at third.
Pitcher refusing to give up for the Dragons here. Still putting the ball in a very competitive spot. Easton Beatty still battling in the box for a full count.
Hill flinched a little bit on that one. Looked like it was aimed for him, but then he realized, no, it's not quite this far out. Full count. Slavin from the stretch.
Easton Beatty with a swing and a miss.
It's his second strikeout of the of the game.
I know he's not happy about it, but I will say Easton usually does hold his composure very well. Gavin Hill, now batting for the Anderson County Mavericks.
That was a great at-bat from Easton on that one.
Yes.
Now we got Gavin Hill, like you said, he reached on an error in the first inning and popped out foul territory to the catcher in the third.
Out of anybody on this team, I'd say Gavin Hill is probably the most worthy of being due right now. He has the capability to hit. His stats may not be reflecting it at the moment, but I know him from a player aspect. I know he wants to get out there and he wants to perform.
That pitch was a little high.
Gavin Hill.
Stretched right to the shortstop. Bobbled by the shortstop. He's going to let one run score
and
as he comes in. Make it 7-1.
8-1.
8-1.
8-1. So Gavin Hill makes it at first. Trent Strickland scores, as just stated. Luke Langford, the pitcher for Anderson County, through the whole game. Coming in, looking to do some damage or looking to compete. We'll see what Slavin, right?
No, it is Slavin, and it's actually 7-1. We just misread the score right there.
7-1. My bad.
It's still 7-1. Hey, I know you're just trying to get it. You're just trying to give them a little bit of advantage, but that's fine.
My bad.
Nothing wrong with that.
Home team jitters.
Stick with me here. Got to have a little bit of fun. No, the other day when we were doing, when I was doing one of these games, we couldn't keep the balls and strikes right because we were watching some people in the room beside us. 0-1 pitch. Low, but
nicely,
strike
nicely
one.
Placed pitch there.
Nice little framework, too, by the catcher.
Yes.
The top of the order, Aiden Bond, who is one for three. Oh, no, that is
Luke Langford on.
Langford.
Battling in there.
Langford
still
0 for 2 with two strikeouts.
Yes, sir. There we go.
I was looking ahead.
Hey, we're back on schedule now.
We're back on track. You make a mistake, I'll make a mistake with it.
We're back on track.
0 for 2, two outs. Mac and Stacy wanting to go talk to Slavin, trying to give Slavin. He's probably trying to talk to him about, calm down, you're almost out of this inning. We just don't want to give up another run. So
yes.
Keep it within play.
Keep it cool. Trust your defense behind you.
The potential winning run is on deck. No, the potential winning run's in the hole right now. Because remember, it's 10 runs
after five.
He just doesn't want to see anyone else come up to bat in this inning.
Yes.
Are they making a change? It looks like they might be making a change, but I'm not sure.
Cool.
They are making a change. Dallas Beats is coming in from right field to pitch. Dallas Beats coming in. Isaiah Slavin will more than likely be going to right field. So Dallas Beats is the new pitcher for the Dragons. They have pulled Isaiah Slavin.
Now pitching for the Mavericks.
I have not yet to see him pitch at all this season. I don't know what his stats include.
I will pull up his stats. He's one of them that I do not believe I pulled. I know I did the stats earlier, so let me check and see if I can find his stats. Dallas Beats, as we keep talking, I'm going to keep looking for it. There we go. Dallas Beats pitching. This will be his third appearance. He has a high 8.75 ERA, 5 strikeouts to 6 walks.
A little bit rough there. What's the class on him by chance?
He is a junior, if I'm not mistaken. I will find that out right here for us as well.
I was going to say, he's got a pretty unique arm slot there.
He does. Dallas Beats came in. He pitched against CAK. It was not CAK. It was one of the most recent games. I'll find out who it was here in just a moment. It was CAK who he came up and helped pitch against. I'm pretty sure on that one. But either way, I will find that out as I'm looking for his stats to find his name on the roster. My phone wanted to be a little bit slow.
All good. I was going to say, so far from his warm-ups, he looks like he's a pretty off-speed, heavy type of guy. I mean, doesn't seem like he's going to throw anything that'll blow by you, but, I mean, based on the movement that I've seen from these first couple throws by him, he looks like that he's willing to not necessarily throw trash, but throw some competitive stuff that's going to make the batter have to work and think.
And Dallas Beats is a junior.
Gavin Hill still on first base for the Mavs with two outs. Luke Langford with two strikes on him.
Pitch from Beats, a little high for ball one. I'm going to call that a three-quarter arm, not quite a sidearm.
I was going to say maybe a little bit lower than a three-quarter, but still, he gets great movement off the ball there. Ball two.
There we go.
In the dirt.
He pitched against Volunteer, was his only.
Volunteer.
That was his pitch. And I know you know Volunteer because you saw him right after we did.
Yes, sir.
That was the last game he pitched. So it's a 2-2 count now. Two outs, lots of twos across the board. Runner at first. Pitch.
Luke Langford. Swing. Foul ball. Or maybe.
They did call it interference. Did they call catcher interference?
No, they're just handing it back to him.
I guess it went off the catcher when he fouled it and he didn't catch it.
That would make sense.
I was like you. I saw him do that, and I was wondering why he was walking.
I didn't know if he tipped his glove or what all happened there. I thought he was going to go talk to the field umpire.
I did, too, for that one. So we got a 2-2 count. Checks the runner at first. The pitch.
Very close. That pitch definitely could have gone either way.
This umpire's been –
He's been very consistent, I will say.
On both sides.
Yes, he's been giving it both ways.
So we got a full count now.
Luke Langford.
Trying to get on base for the first time tonight. Runner goes.
Yeah, no, leaving early with fourth
way ball. Outside. But that is the first time he has been on base tonight. So nice little at-bat right there for Luke Langford.
Dugout would be saying right now, if Luke Langford were to eat another ham sandwich, maybe he would have had a hit there.
I like that one. I've not heard that one yet.
Eat another ham sandwich.
Aiden Bond coming up to bat. He is 1-for-3. With a triple, a flyout, and a strikeout.
Yes, sir.
Now you got runners on first and second with two outs for Dallas Beats. Runner at second is credited to Isaiah Slavin. Runner at first is credited to Dallas Beats. I'll run down your infield right now. It's Beats pitching, Mack catching. The rest of the infield goes Lee, Hensley, Duggins, and JP, or Jumbo as they call him. Outside for ball one. 7-1 your score here in the bottom of the fifth. Potential game-winning run for Anderson County
is on deck
with Reese Wilkerson. Pitch from Beats.
Caught on the outside corner. Very good placement of the pitch right there by Beats.
Still have to find a name for that arm slot that he's using. Yeah, like you're right. It's not quite three quarters.
One half, three corner.
Maybe eight-tenths? Yeah. Call it eight-tenths or something?
Well, that'd be the same as four-fifths.
Either way. Yeah, exactly. Give you that one. That was a good one right there. So, you go 2-1 count now as that one was inside.
Yes, sir.
So, you got to have some – we've been having fun up here last 2 days. I know you enjoyed working with Brian Ford and Anthony Hinkle on Monday. Here's the pitch.
Aiden Ball with a swing and a miss. A little bit big there.
So, see, that one was a little bit off-speed. He wasn't ready for the off-speed on that
one. No, sir. I think he was looking fastball and looking to do a little bit of damage here. I know for a fact, though, now with the count 2-2, he's definitely looking to just put the ball in play, potentially move the boys over.
He does pop it up. This looks like second baseman.
Will it get down?
Calling for it. He does get the third out of the inning. So that makes it two runs on – two runs on – One hit, one error, two runners left. After five, your score 7-1. The Mavericks lead the Clinton Dragons. What have you noticed that's different tonight than was there Monday?
I'm going to say for the Anderson County Mavericks, something I've noticed is I feel like we're just a lot more aggressive whenever it comes to the plate. I mean, I know we've had three goose eggs for the second, third, and fourth inning there, but I feel like we're slowly starting to find our ability to hit. We're definitely got a more out. I don't know what the word would be. Not a big enough vocabulary over here.
No, you're fine.
But we're definitely looking to hit the pitches that are provided.
Not sure.
Would be one way to say that. I'd also say the errors by Clinton, or the just rough placed balls by Anderson County in the first inning, has definitely. Definitely helped Anderson County out here. I mean, there's only so much you can do. I mean, the pitcher, he's not like he was throwing bad at all. I mean, he was competing up there. He was throwing competitive pitches, and we were just hitting it in spots that were either unable to be fielded or just minor slip-ups that just come, especially early in the season. So I think that's the biggest thing that has shaped out this game.
The errors have been a big thing. I'm not going to read the box score right now, but we got Garrett Lee leading off the top of the sixth inning for the Dragons. Here's the pitch. Popped up.
Morgan Clark chasing over, running over with the out.
Catch.
Right on the fence.
One pitch, one out here in the top of the sixth inning. Big out right there for Morgan Clark. I wasn't sure if that was going in the bullpen or not. Yeah. It was close. Next up, Jackson Webb. He's 0 for 2 today with a strikeout.
Still with Luke Lankford pitching for the Anderson County Mavericks here.
Jackson Webb, once again, one of the young ones for the Dragons. There's the first pitch. He grounds it towards Clark, but foul ball. Clark all over that one. I think he was trying to hit Coach Witt with that foul ball, but Clark stopped it.
Clark said, "I'll protect you, Coach. I know you're not my coach, but I'll protect you."
Clark would protect any coach out there, team it is.
Yeah.
Sun's starting to set here. Lights turning on in the outfield here at Merle Albright Field.
We're getting into that weird lighting, especially for the outfielders or just fielders in general on the left side of the field.
Swing and a miss for strike two.
I know that sun and those trees combined with the lights from the field, they're just makes it a little bit tricky to see that ball sometimes.
Jackson Webb shortening up. He's going to shorten it up right here with an 0-2 count. Way outside for ball one. Probably a purposeful miss right there to see if he could get him to chase.
Luke Lankford with a little bit of a grin right there after that one.
may have released that one just a hair earlier than he wanted to. 1-2 pitch to Webb.
Bang, right towards Reese down the line
down
for
the third
fair
baseline.
Ball.
Webb rounding first, going to second. Will he make it to second in time? He makes it sliding, almost could have stood up, but nice little double right there for the sophomore Jackson Webb. As Jumbo J.P. Robbins comes up to bat with one out here in the top of the sixth and one runner on. Still not sure why they call him Jumbo. I will have to ask Isaiah Slavin or Harrison Shelton how he got that nickname. I could call him Michael Jordan with his number, but I'm not so sure he'd like that one either. Sophomore Jackson Webb on second. Freshman J.P. Robbins at the plate. High, almost probably almost close to his helmet on that one. JP, not the tallest player for the Dragons.
Hey, everybody's got their spot on the team. I mean, obviously he's in the lineup for some reason, and size isn't everything.
No, size isn't.
Especially not in baseball. I mean, football, you got to have a little bit of mass, but baseball's different than a lot of other sports.
Nice little pitch on the outside corner for strike one. Yeah, JP, we interviewed him after the game, and he had one of the most humble guys. His time is called as Bond comes up to talk to Lankford. Bond.
I was going to say, if I had to take a guess here, it's probably because Luke hasn't been getting his signs from the shortstop. I noticed that, but.
That's one thing I wouldn't have noticed, but I wouldn't have said anything. You enjoy. He's still looking over there at the shortstop. Now he's getting the call from him. So he hasn't really been checking for that call, I guess.
Yeah, or not since he gone on second base.
which is a little bit smart. Bond is a great infield captain, I'll call him.
Yes, I would agree with that statement.
Nice little foul ball right there for JP on that one.
In a way, him being the size he is, I mean, I'm not trying to poke fun or make fun of him in any way. I mean, I respect him. He's in there for a reason, but one advantage for him is that with him being smaller, he's got a smaller strike zone, which, I mean, I know he's not necessarily looking for a walk. Nobody really goes up there looking for a walk, but it definitely gives their team an advantage. I mean, while they may lack a little bit of power due to weight, but especially if you've got a guy that's a little bit more wild, that's definitely could be an advantage.
The 1-2 pitch popped him up, going short outfield to the second baseman. Will he make the catch?
Alex Bond takes it for himself.
And Aiden was covering second just in case Webb tried to go.
Alex Duggins.
Next up,
two outs for the inning right there.
Next up, Alex Duggins. And I want to give credit to JP. He has made contact in every at-bat. He's
popped
out or flat out every time today.
He's definitely doing his fair share of fighting in the box. He has not gone down looking.
We got Alex Duggins. He is 0 for 2 with two strikeouts.
Luke Lankford again forgetting to get his sign from Aiden Bond, just met about it. Rogue pitch.
Outside for ball one. I know Jackson Webb does have at least one stolen base on the season. So that's probably why he's trying to keep him in a little bit closer. Webb taking a little bit of a larger lead than I've seen in this game. Now he's kind of sliding back, trying to bounce around a little bit.
Luke Lankford giving him a generous gander.
Outside for ball two. I think Lankford, based on the location of the first two pitches, is he's kind of expecting him to try to go. He's trying to expect yes. him to go, and he wants Ty Wilson to throw him out to Reese Wilkerson.
I could definitely see that being an idea for sure. I mean, even that ball was still on the outside corner right there.
Yeah, it wasn't quite as high, but that was a good location to get the first strike
yes,
of the
sir.
At-bat. Maybe after this game, I'll see if Coach Stacy and maybe even Coach Boynton want to come up here and say a few words about this, because we know both the coaches are good friends too, high and outside
oh, yeah.
of ball three. There's a big respect between these two teams, except for days when you play each other. But as soon as that game's over, there's respect. The respect resumes.
100%.
I'll go in and look at some of the scores around the area after this, see if we can find out what that final from the Gibbs-Scott game two was. Also check Claiborne and Union County.
Bang. Luke Lankford hanging in there.
Making
like
the
a hair
full.
And a biscuit, just holding on. Not doesn't want to quite give up for a walk here. Count 3-2 with two outs, runner on second base.
Hensley wanting to come up. Hensley itching to come up in this inning. 3-2 pitch. Check swing.
Called. Strike three.
Nice little pitch
for
right
Luke
there.
Langford.
For Luke Lankford. That
getting the Mavericks out of the inning. That was a big.
And that's three strikeouts on the day for Duggins. That is, I'll double check the numbers, but that's either seven or eight strikeouts for Lankford tonight. Let's see. That will be seven strikeouts.
Seven strikeouts
for
Lankford. That's great for Mavericks. Little bias right there.
Well, no,
great for the Mavericks.
It's great for any pitcher to get seven or
yeah.
even close to double digits. But right now, I'm going to read through the box line. It's a little bit different. So the Mavericks lead it with seven runs on four hits, no errors. This is according to Game Changer. The Dragons have one run on six hits and eight errors tonight. That's different. They usually
that's hard on any team. Errors will kill you.
They usually don't throw, but maybe one max a game. But eight tonight is – this is just not their night.
That's heavy.
So, let's see. Leading off
– I would say, in my opinion, I think probably a good majority of those came from the first and second inning.
They did because they
say,
were all nine batters.
If you were to take those two innings out, I think it would be closer to a 2-1 ball game. Or
I'll say the first and fifth inning because the second inning was a 1-2-3 inning on that one. Third inning, they allowed one – third inning – you had two runners get on. You had three runners get on, but no one scored. But the fifth inning, you went all the way down.
Yeah.
So Union County leads Cumberland Gap 6-1 in the bottom of the sixth.
It is Gibbs 1, Lenore City 0.
Lenore City leading Gibbs 2-1. That's not a district game, but that is a good game from against a good Lenore City team that we have both seen play this year.
Yes.
Leading off. In this inning, should be Wilkerson, Wilson, and then Clark trying to get seven for his last seven.
2-3-4 for the Anderson County Mavericks. Reese Wilson, great guy on and off the field. Ty Wilson, dog behind the plate.
And up to
Morgan Clark, just a all-around good dude with a great family.
And up to pitch now, we have a new pitcher for the Dragons. It is Jackson Barrett. Jackson Barrett, this will be his third appearance. He has a 6.3 ERA, one save, three strikeouts, and six walks. Jackson, I believe, is a junior, but I will double-check my roster here. Jackson, he came in and got a big save against Volunteer. He actually got the save in that game and the win.
All right.
So let's see. I'm pulling up my roster now. If my phone doesn't want to freeze like it likes to a lot of times.
Number 10, Reese Wilkerson.
As Reese Wilkerson comes up to bat, Jackson Barrett is a junior.
All righty. A little bit of junior on junior competition right here.
Years. First pitch from Barrett. Low in the dirt for ball one. Dragons looking to try to force a top of the seventh inning in this game. Mavericks looking to walk it off in the bottom of the sixth. 1-0 count, no outs, inside corner for strike one. That was close.
Yes, Reese Wilkerson just said, that one's not for me, or as I can best guess for him. I'm sure he's going to hang through this, though, and do his best. So,
Reese tonight is 1-for-3 with a single.
Coming in, Reese wasn't a move there. He probably had a pretty good chance of getting hit there. Ball was closer in than the that previous one called strike.
That was, and once again, Reese is 1-for-3 with a single today. So the 2-1 pitch from Barrett. fouled back to even the count at 2-2.
Reese fighting as well as the pitcher.
As the Adams Family music plays over the loudspeakers.
Well, of course.
Got to.
Got to add a little bit of suspense here.
Got to have some flair to it.
Yes, yes, yes. Ty Wilson on deck timing him up.
The pitch from Barrett. Almost hit him.
Almost hit.
That one was even closer than that second pitch. Full count now for the leadoff batter here in the bottom of the sixth inning. So it looks like you got Sam Duggins, Harrison Shelton covering his eyes in center. Here's the pitch. High
Reese
for ball four.
Almost loses his self-control there. He almost gives in and wants to swing, but he held off for the walk.
And that's the second time he's been on bat today.
Number eight, Ty Wilson.
T. Willie coming in.
Wilson is
running on first.
Also 1-for-3 today with a single. Or no, sorry about that. Wilson is 0-for-3 today. He reached on an error in the first inning. Here's the pitch. High for ball one. It's been 7-1 your score here at Merle Albright Field. Next broadcast for Dragon Vision will be tomorrow night at home as the Dragons host the Davy Crockett Pioneers. 1-0 pitch.
Ty
foul
Wilson.
Back. Go ahead.
Oh, my bad.
No, you're good. Go ahead.
I was going to say Ty Wilson swinging off for a foul ball. The count is 1-1.
Well, what's Ty's only reached on error today. What's he looking to do in this at bat?
If I had to know Ty, Ty's probably looking to put it between the center field and right field gap, knowing him, or try and push it oppo towards the AC logo in the left field center field gap.
Runner goes, Mac up with it. Nice throw by Mac.
Makes it there.
Underneath the glove.
Doesn't commit to going third on the pass ball.
Harrison Shelton and Hensley both backing up that throw. That's another stolen base, though, for the Mavericks. I'll have to check and see how many that is today. 2-1 count.
Ty Wilson with runner in scoring position. Probably thinking, if I were him, try not to get too big here.
3-1 count as Barrett misses on that one. Pulling up my stats right here. That is stolen base number 3 on the day for the Mavericks. 3-1 pitch. Grounded towards the hole in the second base, but second baseman
and
all over
through.
His glove.
A little runners bit of an error there. Reese Wilkerson commits to taking four, and he's there.
Hensley
up.
Will not throw. So a run on the error, the ninth error of the game for the Dragons, makes it an 8-1 score, and the second time he's reached on an error. Or no,
yes,
he reached on an error on that one. Second time yes. He's reached on an error tonight.
Yes, sir. Sticks Morgan Clark coming up.
See if Morgan's going to try to make it 7 for his last 7, making it on base.
I mean, if he could do that, that'd be phenomenal.
As Will Ridenour, courtesy runs for Wilkerson. No,
Will.
Not Wilkerson, for Wilson, the catcher.
Yes, Will Ridenour.
Also
he is
a
sophomore for Anderson County.
Very good relief pitcher as well.
Yes, he's made a lot of improvement from last year. I mean, he's got a lot of upside. I mean, I know he's had a couple of tough situations in and out throughout his life. I mean, those aren't for me to share, but he's hanging in there.
We're not asking him, and you all have taken him in, and you all have helped him come through it.
Yes, for sure.
Barrett behind in the count 1-0 to Clark. Here's the pitch. Pop down the first base or down the third
Will
base line.
Down.
It's going deep. Caught on
Ball
a nice
caught.
Little catch right there by and Sam Duggins.
No runners advance.
No runners advance, and I think I gave him the jinx. For the first out of the last 7 at-bats for Morgan Clark. I think I gave him the jinx on that one.
I mean, still, that's great contact. I mean, you can't.
No, you can't fault him on that one.
Exactly. I mean, that ball was hit perfect right on that line. I mean, if that ball would have gotten down, that could have easily been a double, potentially a triple there.
You got to give Sam Duggins a great job.
Yes, that was a great play,
one.
Too. He read that ball right off the bat. Trent Strickland now for the Mavericks.
Barrett looking for a double play to end the inning. Swing and a miss for strike one. Trent Strickland
gives into the high fastball for sure.
He's actually 3-for-3 today, or 2-for-2 today with 2 singles and a walk.
Well, we will see what Trent has to do. Hopefully he can keep his momentum here. I mean, we got a runner on first.
I'm not going to say anything like I did for the last batter. So we got 0-1 count, 1 out, runner goes. Mack gets the catch, throws
ball
it away.
Thrown away.
Gets over to center, but
Will Ridenour nice. Decides to stay on the second base.
Harrison running up quick enough to try not to allow another runner to get to third. See how that one was called on Game Changer. Does say a stolen base.
E2 is what I believe that was marked.
E2 up here.
Pitcher for the Dragons, keeping Will Ridner on second base. A little bit humble there.
Will's got a few stolen bases this year, I think.
He has a few, yes.
He's got a 1-1 count, one out here. No more double play ball. Pop
Trent
up.
Strickland with a fly
down the
ball.
Left field, third base running for
it.
No, it will go out of play.
It will be foul.
So 1-2 count as the Atlanta Braves music starts to play over the loudspeakers.
Of course. Why not, yeah. Right?
Me being a big Braves fan, my first year I ever played, Chipper Jones was a rookie.
How dare you be a Braves fan?
How dare I be a Braves fan?
How dare you be a Braves fan?
Let me guess, you're a Mets fan or a Yankees fan?
No. Yuck.
There's a pop-up going down the first baseline. Garrett Lee underneath it. Will he make the catch?
No.
No, it goes right over his outstretched glove. Still a 1-2
count. Trent Strickland with another life.
He's down to his third life now. Two of them are gone from the last two foul balls.
If he would have caught it, would have been out. I mean, he's got two strikes on him.
So he's down to his third life.
Easily. He's hanging in there.
We'll see if he's a cat and has seven lives in the set bat.
Yeah, I thought cats had nine.
Nine, seven, either way. It works. One ball, two strikes, one out. Runner dancing at second. The pitch.
Call strike three
on the inside corner. Nice little strikeout there by Jackson Barrett.
That's one of those strikeouts right there. You just got to tip your hat to the pitcher and move on. I mean, that was great pitch placement by the Clinton Dragons right there for that strikeout. Alex Bond now coming up for the Anderson County Mavericks.
I haven't marked it the right way, but he's been on base twice
far.
Well. I'll see what it says on the box score. Alex Bond wearing number three.
Number one.
Aiden wears. It says he is 1-for-3 with an RBI and a run. So, I mean, he reached on an error on one of them.
Let's see what he's got here. Will Ridner taking.
And he laces it right by the shortstop.
Alex going to hit right up the middle. Will Ridner attempting to make it four. And he will, standing.
To make it a 9-1 lead. Bottom of the sixth, 9-1 lead. Alex Bond now 2-for-4 on the night. As Easton Beatty comes up to bat. Let you go ahead. Easton Beatty 0-for-3 with two strikeouts.
Yes, sir. Easton Beatty now coming in. Alex Bond on first base.
Easton Beatty representing the walk-off, the winning run for the Anderson County Mavericks.
And he wears it.
I think that one hit him right in the middle of the numbers.
It did. Easton Beatty taking one for the team right there. I know nobody wants to stand in there and wear it, especially off the center of your back, but I think he realizes in order to get to that run rule, you've got to do things you don't always want, and that shows how good of a team player he really is.
Gavin Hill
coming in.
He has reached base twice today. He walked and reached on an error in the first inning.
Good take.
First pitch low and outside for ball one.
Alex
9-1 your score.
My bad.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, Alex Bond dancing a little bit there on second base.
I think he's been dancing for like the last 2 or 3 minutes out there trying to confuse.
Hey, I mean, we've got a lot of energy right now. Gavin Hill pulled hard, but it is foul.
That one could have scored both runs.
Potentially, yes, sir.
1-1 count, two outs, bottom of the sixth inning. As we see it on the scoreboard, Mavericks scored 5 in the first and 2 in each of the fifth and sixth innings so far. Dragons scored their lone run in the top of the fifth. Jackson Barrett pitching. 1-1 count, two outs. Here's the pitch.
Gavin Hill with a ball that may get through, and it gets
through. One
Alex
run
Bond
will
being
score.
Sent to the fourth.
He's going to stay at third.
And he makes it in.
And Max slows it down to make sure no one advances to third. Still runners at first and second, a 10-1 score.
Luke Lankford, the pitcher for Anderson County, coming back in with the I Shot the Sheriff playing as he enters the box.
He has
looking to do something big here.
He has made it on base once tonight via walk. He's also struck out twice. Pitch to Langford. High for ball one.
A little bit of chin music to start off the AB.
Winning run on – potential winning run on second base for the Mavericks.
All Luke Langford here has to do, all Luke Langford has to do here is just keep calm and not try and do too much. I think that'd be the best way. Ball getting through the
run
catcher.
Over.
Easton Beatty attempting for three, and he makes it on
double
time.
Double steal on that pass ball. 2-0 count. Runners now at second and third. Winning run on third base. 2-0 count, two outs. Jackson Barrett on the mound for the Dragons.
Luke Langford with two runners in scoring position. Two outs and two balls, as previously said.
The pitch, foul back.
Luke Langford battling, or not quite battling, but swinging.
Swinging. Jackson Barrett trying to battle this
yes,
to get back in this.
I think that's what I was trying to say, but English just isn't English right now.
English isn't English. I'll give that one to you. 2-1 count, two outs. Also, batter number 20 in bat on the day. So, a lot of twos on the board right now. High for ball three.
Chin music part two for the same AB. Count now 3-1. Luke Langford. Confidence in the swing here, but.
Aiden Bond wanting, itching to get his
yes.
play on base to try to knock in that winning run. 3-1 count. The pitch. Outside for ball four.
Luke Langford looks in question as he thought that was a called strike.
So,
and he makes it. Bases loaded with Aiden Bond, the shortstop for Anderson County. Coming in.
Aiden Bond.
Two hit.
Has a triple on the day. He's 1-for-4.
Pinch running for the Mavericks, number 9, John Johnson.
As John Johnson comes on, the courtesy run for the Mavericks.
That ain't no John Johnson over that. That is June.
June,
as
June.
We call him. We call him June.
So we'll call, I'll let you get
We got it. June on first base, sub running right now for the pitcher.
With senior Aiden Bond up to bat. Bases loaded, one run away. The pitch. Fouls
swinging.
It back. He's on it. He's wanting to get that last
he's
run.
He's itching.
In. He does not want to have to come out for the top of the seventh
no,
inning.
No, he does not. He is itching to get this over with.
If he makes contact, I'm letting you call it.
You sure?
Oh, yeah, I'm going to let you
butcher
call it.
Aiden Bond with a taken fastball on the outside corner. Good pitch placement by the Dragons right there. Count 0-2. Still, bases loaded.
Jackson
a lot
Barrett.
Of nerve on both sides right here.
Jackson Barrett looking to force the top of the seventh inning to have to happen. Here's the pitch.
Aiden Bond with a swing and a miss for strike three. The Dragons barely squeeze by to get to the top of the seventh.
So, Aiden... As he said, Aiden Bond strikes out. It's the second time he struck out today. Jackson Barrett getting out of a bases-loaded threat after allowing three Mavericks to cross the plate, making it 10-1. Up next for the Clinton Dragons, if I could see my numbers right, will be the bottom of the order, Hensley Beats, and then the top of the order, Jace Mack. Barring any kind of changes, we'll put it that way, barring any kind of changes, it'll be 8-9-1 coming up to bat. It's getting a great night here for baseball. I saw Shelton in center field having to shield his eyes from how the lights are coming. The lights and the sun.
It creates a really weird lighting. Ball likes to blend in. But then you have other parts where ball is vivid. I mean, it's just one of those things. Anderson County playing. Luke Langford still on the mound, attempting to go for a complete game here. Ty Wilson behind the dish. Reese Wilkerson on third base. Aiden Bond playing shortstop. Alex Bond on second base, the younger brother. Morgan Clark still hanging on to that first base. Center field, we have Trent Strickland. Left field, we have Trey Rowe in right field with Easton Beatty, the Mavericks defense, for the last, hopefully for them, the last inning while the Dragons battle to catch up.
And Braden Hensley will be leading off for the Dragons. I wasn't sure if they were going to make any switches just yet or not. Who's up next for the Mavericks to play tomorrow night or tomorrow afternoons? I know there's a tomorrow afternoon and tomorrow night the Mavericks have a game. Who are they playing?
Clay County? Giles County.
Giles County. I know you do play Clay County sometime this weekend. You got one up here saying he's going to play his relatives, Giles County, coming up next. Got 0-0 count, first pitch in there for strike one.
Luke Langford still. A lot of movement seen from pitchers on both sides. I mean, both have had great fastball movement as well as off-speed And, I mean, that's been an advantage for both. Like we've talked about earlier, I mean, you take away the first inning, and I believe it was the fifth inning, and this ball game could be totally different. Luke Langford with an HBP for the night.
Brayden Hensley wearing it on his shoulder. He makes it on base for the first time tonight, bringing up Dallas Beats. Actually, no, Jackson Barrett will be the pinch hitter for Dallas Beats. I'll have to pull up Jackson Barrett's numbers on the season while we're while there's a little bit of a courtesy runner.
A little bit of transition time here.
Gideon, forgive me, Gideon, for not remembering your last name, but Gideon on base for the Dragons to courtesy run.
Luke Langford for Lanners County Mavericks, looking a little bit stressed, a little bit disappointed in himself. As a player and as a pitcher, I mean, I know you just – that one bites really hard. That one stings, but you just – you got to flush it and you got to move on. I mean, you got to pitch with a lead here and have some confidence. I mean, trust the boys behind you. Trust yourself to do what you need to get done for your team.
Jackson Barrett has scored 6 times but not had an official plate appearance this season.
Luke Langford for a strike in there.
Swing and a miss.
Yes, sir.
Strike one. Strike two. Strike one. Here, a little bit more talking coming out from the crowds on both sides.
Check
swing, goes
chirping.
For a back pick.
Oh!
Does make it in time, just barely. Had he thrown it to the inside of the bag, that probably would have been an out.
Ty Wilson. That was a very good heads-up play by the catcher.
That was a great stretch by Morgan Clark,
yes,
trying to
sir.
Get that out, too.
Yes, sir.
Just went to the wrong shoulder. That might have been out number one. The 1-1 pitch. Right down
strike
the middle.
Two. Right down the pipe.
One ball, two strikes. No outs. You got Gideon at first. Jackson Barrett at the plate. Top of the order after this with Mack. Here's the pitch. High, maybe just a hair outside
Luke,
for ball
yeah,
two.
With a great pitch. I mean, that was very competitive. That pitch could have gone either way, but that was a very good spot and very good discipline by the Dragons right there.
Great framework right there by Wilson as well, giving him the right spot to hit. 2-2 count, no outs. The pitch. High again, ball three. That one just a little further away than the last pitch.
That ball almost looked like a potential pitch out right there. And, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they were looking to see if he would go for that. But
let's see. I'm going to try to pull up Gideon. Since I messed up, I'm going to try to pull up Gideon's last name for the Dragons.
Swing and a miss for strike three.
Jackson,
first out.
Yeah, Jackson Barrett strikes out in his first official plate appearance. Gideon Follett. On first
yes,
for the
sir.
Dragons, as we're back at the top of the order with catcher Jace Mack.
A little bit of that sun out here on the ballpark now. Field's gone shaded, but that RB sign is lit up.
Is that where you're going to go after this?
Me? Probably not. More than likely, I'll probably go home.
Go home?
A little bit cheaper, I mean.
Yeah, just a hair.
I don't have the most money.
No,
that's all right.
Just make Morgan take you out.
Honestly,
0-1
yeah.
Count, one out for Jace. This is Jace Mack. The pitch.
Clark, if we win, you're taking the team out on you.
We'll make sure he goes back and listens to the top of the seventh.
I hope he hears. He better be going back to listen.
He better be. We've given him a lot of credit. It's just been a
great game for
the Mavericks. Dragons not so much tonight, but they'll be back in action tomorrow night.
I mean,
hopefully
we all have
to
rough
recover.
Days. All of off days.
0-2 count, one out. 10-1 your score. Time called just in the nick of time by Jace Mack.
Luke Langford finishing out that throw with an ethos.
Looked like he was about in the middle of his windup
yes,
when they called time.
Yeah, that was a little close, but I mean, hey, that happens.
Follett on first, Mack at home. Mack looking to keep the inning alive. Here's the pitch.
Bang!
Wasted it, but foul.
Oh. That could have been a very very clutch hit for the Dragons there. That could have got a lot of energy moving for them if that ball would have been landed fair.
Yeah, Mack up, Shelton on deck, Slavin in the hole. followed by Lee if it can make it to either of them. The heart of the big part of the order for the Dragons up right now. Follett taking the lead. Pitch grounded over.
Roll over. Clark right just over can't head. Quite get up. Ball called
they call
fair.
A fair ball. Follett running to third. Firing it in. Stopped by Bond. Bond checking
with
first. Gets it back to Mack. But they call it safe.
Oh.
Home plate umpire called him safe. And you can see Clark has a little smile, grin on his face. Thought he had it, but not quite. Nice little hit right there by Mack. Second time he's been on. Third, he's been on base today. So you got Follett on second.
A little bit of a deep breath here for me.
Yeah, I know you got.
I'm getting a little antsy here. I mean, I love watching.
You got courtesy runner coming on, Matt Denton for the Dragons. Not sure if he's made any kind of appearances yet this year at base running or anything like that. He's normally sort of a relief pitcher as your pitching coach goes out to talk.
Coach Tanner Williams for the Anderson County. Coming out to talk to Luke Lankford. Probably give him the good old suck it up, son. Don't quit now, if I had to take a guess.
I know Clark's probably over there asking him, can I pitch, coach? Can I pitch? Let me pitch.
Yeah, no, that's definitely the opposite of what Clark's thinking, so don't listen to him. Clark stepped into some shoes to fill here. I mean, we're hurting a little bit for pitching. I will say that. I mean, we're doing really well considering how many people have just now started to throw this year. But, I mean, I know that's – Clark definitely – that's not his preferred place on the field. But if coach tells him to go there, I guarantee Clark will give him a yes, sir, and he'll go out there and give him the best he can.
So you got sophomore Denton on first. Then you've also got sophomore Follett on third. I got to figure out how he pronounces his last name. It's either Follett or Follett. I'm not sure. I'll have to ask him. We got runners at the corners with one out and Harry the Hitman Shelton up to bat. Or Pinky.
With the Pinky. I mean, last time you said Pinky, he had a pretty good piece, so.
He lets the first one go by for strike one. And for some reason, my camera went down, so I'll have to figure out why my camera went down. My camera's up here. Did I hit a button? Yes, I did. There we go.
Hey,
camera's back now. I know exactly
back.
What I did on that one. That was on me. Not sure how long it's been down, but we got runners at the corners. As Harrison up, second pitch to Harrison. Check swing.
Check
did
swing.
They say he go? They do say he
they
went.
They called
for
a strike.
Strike.
0-2, runner on first and third for the Dragons.
Harrison tried as hard as he could to hold back on that one. It was close. But in the end, the umpire has the final call and said it was a strike, and I will tend to agree with that one because it was a bang-bang call either way. 0-2 count, one out, runners at the corners. Dragons trail by 9. The pitch, low, gets away.
Blocked up by Ty Wilson.
No harm, no foul, though, as Denton moves to second, sort of getting rid of the double play option, but does not allow a runner to score, so it's a 1-2 count with one out.
Yes, sir. Great play by Ty Wilson right there.
Very
great, or not block, I guess I could say. It wouldn't be quite a play, but
it
great,
was a,
great reaction.
Considering what's
way to keep it in front.
Right. The one thing they always teach you, keep it in front.
Yes.
1-2 count, one out, runners at second and third. Low
again.
For ball two.
I know Luke
go
Lankford.
Ahead, say it.
Luke Lankford's getting a little bit tired here. I can see that in him. He's losing a little bit of control. Losing a little bit of velo. He's pitched. This is going on the seventh inning. That's a full game, and I mean, I don't know what he's at, but I guarantee he's close to probably 90 to 100, I'd say.
I will check after this pitch as he goes to full count now. Let's see what it says right here. He is at 96 pitches.
96 pitches,
so
yeah.
So you were right on the number.
I was going to say, I knew he was somewhere up in there. I can usually tell. He usually has a little bit of a, I wouldn't say a jump, but I guess a little bit of a drop-off, I mean, which is normal. Usually somewhere right around 80, so.
Full count. He blasts one towards left center field. Left fielder running in. Takes the catch. Follett
does not
look like
attempt.
He was on tag, but he doesn't want to. Nice little throw-in by your left fielder on that one.
Trey Rowe with a beautiful throw-in.
So down, Dragons down to their final out, and it is Isaiah Slavin, as we nicknamed him one time, the snake, by the way he pitched in a few of his games this year. He can, you've seen it yourself, he can slide them in there anywhere.
Yes, sir.
He showed that a little bit tonight in the relief effort.
Yes, sir. The question is at the moment, is can he produce with this type of pressure?
He is the last possible at-bat for the Dragons unless he gets on base. Look. Nice little pitch on the inside corner, and Wilson looked like he wanted to back pit Follett on that one. Follett does have some speed for a sophomore, but we'll see what happens with this one. It's an 0-1 count now from the stretch.
Doing his best.
Fouls it back.
I mean, that's not a bad swing. I mean, you could tell. I think he was trying to take that pitch oppo there.
Slaving down to his last strike, and the last strike of the night for the Dragons. I'll let you call it.
All righty. Luke Langford, great tail on that ball, but just a bit outside.
I think it tailed the opposite direction he wanted it to.
Yeah, I mean, that definitely wasn't a cutter. That was probably a two-seam if I had to take for a one-seam based on just the tremendous movement on that. I mean, he's got a little bit of wind helping him there.
It was a great pitch.
Yeah,
US,
I mean,
though.
Yeah.
Here's the pitch.
Strike three for the Anderson County Mavericks. Anderson County will go home with the win to even out the series 1-1. Anderson County wins by 10 through 7 innings.
Not through 9, 10-1.
Oh.
You were close. I'll give you that one, though. It was a 10-1 win. We're going to take a break for a minute as we figure out who wants to come up to talk for either side. We're going to take a break. If you want to go down there and shake hands with
yes,
your
– Yes, sir.
We can.
Thank you again for the opportunity
what?
Being on here.
We'll be right back on Dragon Vision. Welcome back to Clinton Dragon Baseball here on Dragon Vision. I'm here with head coach Stacy. Stacy, talk about this game.
Well, like I told the guys out there, it is not a game. Again, it's a district game, but you can't, and it's the first district series. You got multiple after this. You got multiple more games. You know, you got Davy Crockett coming tomorrow to home, and you've also got Sevier County coming, Bryan Station, University High. Like, those are four good teams that are coming up, and we have to do a better job as coaches to relay that message. We can't live and die on every game.
No, and like you said, this is only game two. We have 10 games in the district.
Yep.
It's very early. We're used to playing this team at the end of the season, not
absolutely
the beginning. So this is early. What were some of the bright spots you saw from, like, some of your younger players that got in?
Well, maybe not a younger player, but Sam Duggins threw his tail off. You know, we gotta do a better job behind him playing defense. He did exactly what we wanted. We wanted ground balls, and he did exactly what we wanted. We just got to make those plays, and I think that falls on me as a coach. I've got to get him a little bit more better prepared in practice, taking more ground balls, putting our nose to the grindstone, and putting in more work. That's what I told him out there, guys, is basically you've put in work. Nobody doubts the work that you've put in, but in order to get to the level that you want to go, you have to put even more work in. And that comes on my shoulders too. You know, I try to lead by example with my work ethic in the mornings and always lifting and try to do it that way. But I've got to maybe probably take some of these guys under my wing and kind of take them with me and show them exactly what that's like. So
groom them in your own.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. But you know, usually sometimes we lose these games and it's like that, and I might not do an interview afterwards, but. You know, the message this year is this is a long season. We've, for 5 years, we've lived and died on big games. And in the next three games, you have a fall off. But I think this group will figure it out. It's a senior team. I think they'll figure it out. We had some young guys step up again. Jackson Webb made a heck of an adjustment. And is it bad? He listened to Coach Long, and he had success. JP went out there and did the best he possibly could for us. You know, still proud of him. But we've got to have some guys that, you know, maybe on the weekends, let's put a little bit more work in. Like, I know that everybody needs a rest. I'm big on rest, but sometimes if you're struggling, you got to put in just a little bit more work. And what happens when you put in that more work, you don't press as much.
Right. And you called JP out. JP made contact on every at-bat, whether it was positive or an out. He made contact in everyone, and you could see him adjust throughout. I want to give Jumbo big credit for that.
Yeah, he did. He did a good job for us. And then, you know, Harrison had another good game. He's seeing the ball well, and you know, his leadership is really good. You know, he gets the guys going. He also lets the guys know when they make mistakes in a positive manner. You know, in the past we've had some issues where we've had to learn how to be positive in the mistakes, and you know, it falls again on my shoulders. Sometimes I might get a little too hot, but I've been working on that a lot this year as a coach. Again, you can always learn as a coach.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what I want them to see, is like we're going to work too, and our coaching staff's going to go back and we're going to talk about this and hash out some things and try to get some things working for us for tomorrow against Crockett.
What do you want to say to Coach Boynton and the AC admins about allowing us to do this as well?
Oh, I mean, it's fantastic. I mean, again, like, it's a great place to be. It's a great county to work in. And it starts at the top with the leadership of Tim Parrott. It goes down to the principals and Ben Downs and Dan Jenkins, you know, having positive relationships. You know, this rivalry in the past has been kind of, you know, I'm not going to use the word toxic. It's just a little bit too volatile at times. But I think with good people like Josh at the helm, you know, Coach Lockard, you know, Jordan, Coach Gillum, Coach Keith, we've really worked on that with all our sports programs, and we've kind of said let the kids decide the destiny of our teams out on the field, and we've actually became really close. You know, when it comes to them moving on, most of us are texting or calling them and telling them, hey, we hope the best for you, because that's the truth. It's the truth. When our sports programs are strong in Anderson County, it's hard to beat us regardless who's playing. Right. And that has been my message since day one. If you become a strong community that really supports your high school and supports your kids, it's hard to beat other teams. And it's really us versus Knox County sometimes when it comes to that situation. And, again, I'm friends with some guys in Knox County. Des, not to, like, say that, but, I mean, being one county, you know, Coach, you know, Dr. Parrott talks about that every student every day, and I really believe that message.
And we had big crowds the last 2 days. What does that say to you?
Again, you know, that's what I've been asking for. You know, some people might be like, why is he saying this stuff on – social media. You know, I sometimes share my opinions on social media, and then later I kind of regret it, but that's just who I am. But to see the crowd here tonight, to have the crowd we had last night, Josh should be proud. I'm very proud of just our community support for baseball right now. It's fantastic. I mean, we've got two really good teams in our county, and that's what we like to have, and that's what we hope to have in the future too.
And now right before we might sign off, we might try to go get Boynton. What do you want to tell them about the next 3 days? I know we have 4 games in 3 days.
Well, first off, let me tell –
go ahead.
Hats off to Josh and them for coming in ready to play.
Yes.
You know, both of us looked a little flat in the first inning and during in and outs, and that was my message to the team. We both kind of looked flat. And then when you give a team energy, it's hard to get the energy back, especially when you're playing away, especially when it's a rivalry game. That's stuff that we've got to work on and grow. But the next 3 days are, you know, I'm playing David Crockett. I used to coach there with Spencer Street, and they've got a good team this year, man.
We got to see them in a scrimmage, but
we scrimmaged them, but they didn't have a couple of their starters. They're basketball guys, and they went to state, so they know how to win. They've got a belief, and Spencer's doing a great job now in 3A. I fully believe in what he's done. I saw it with my own eyes. Then Casey Taylor with Alumni Night's coming Friday, and we're going to get together on Friday because it's Good Friday and kind of talk to our guys about what Good Friday means in the morning. So I think that's going to be good. And they're a good team. Very good team. And then you got Brian Station coming down with Eric Hagen, who when I played, he coached at Georgetown College. So we've built a real good relationship there, and he's a really good coach, man. Like, I love when I played them in college, I loved it because it was just so intense. When we played them last year, they were a good squad, and we had a good pitching performance from Nick Kidd. And then University High with my buddy Christian Taylor, who got that job this year, and, you know, they're a perennial – they go to state every year in single A. So, again, that goes back to my message. Like, we want to play good teams. We want to play good competition. We want to play good coaches to help prepare us. And I think that we need to go through that stretch to get even more prepared for down this line with all these district games.
Yeah, all the district games coming up really quick. Thank you again for joining us. We're going to be right back. We're going to see if Coach Boynton wants to talk to us from Anderson County after a big 10-1 win. But even though it was a big game for both teams, we'll see how it goes. We'll be right back on Dragon Vision. Welcome back here on Dragon Vision. I'm actually joined now by head coach for the Anderson County Mavericks, Josh Boynton. Congratulations on the big win.
Thank you.
Tell me, what does this mean to you?
You know, it was big. I challenged our guys yesterday. It's important for us to get back even in the district to split for where we want to go. I really feel that I've talked to Coach Stacy about this. You know, I would love nothing more to see both Anderson County schools advance on into the region. So it's really important for us to get back even. So, you know, moving forward for us, and I challenged our guys to get back really even, to get back to 500 over with our overall record. And our starting pitcher, Luke Langford, he was in some trouble in the first inning. We were able to get out of it. And offensively, you know, being able to score five runs in the first inning, I just told our guys, it gives your pitcher a ton of confidence. And that's what it did. Luke kind of settled in and was able to really handle his game. Defensively, guys made plays for him. You know, overall, I think Luke just did a really good job commanding his zone, commanding his off-speed, and kind of kept those hitters. You know, Clinton's got some good hitters in the middle of the lineup. And Luke was able to keep those guys off balance a little bit, get them thinking a little bit. And, you know, that was just a good overall team win for us tonight.
What do you want to say about – I know you were talking about Coach Stacy, about this camaraderie between the two schools and how big the crowds were the last two games.
Absolutely. You know, the atmosphere – was great for at Clinton last night and even here tonight. You know, and Coach Stacy and I have a lot of respect for each other. I consider Rob a really good friend. You know, he does a great job at Clinton. And, you know, I heard him make a comment on Dragon Vision the other night about people in our community sometimes make this rivalry more than what it should be. And yeah, it's a fun rivalry. You know, our guys, we get after it when we're out there. But at the end of the day, I got a lot of love for him and his program and his guys. You know, he's got some really good seniors. There was a point in the game where Garrett Lee was on first base and Luke, you know, we've had a lot of talks with Luke about holding guys on and he was worried about Garrett. And I said, I don't care about him right now. But then I made sure Garrett know. I said, I love him, but I don't care about him right now. You know, in that point in the game, we were up four runs, I think, and I didn't really feel that, you know, Garrett's the type of guy that's going to steal a lot of bases. So I wanted Luke to attack the hitter, and, you know, that's what he did. But, you know, overall, just the atmosphere was really good both nights and, you know, for both home teams. And, you know, moving forward, I expect to, you know, that we're competing for district championship at the end of the year. You know, we're going to be right back in there in May. It's just really weird. You know, we've never had to play each other the first, you know, district series. And when we drew our numbers back when we had our meeting, I looked at Rob and I said, oh, man, like, I don't want to play you right out the gate. But, you know, it is what it is, and it's part of it, you know, and what he did for – you know, for our second baseman, Lane Fletcher, that went down with an injury last night, you know, the Clinton guys praying for him. And Rob called me, reached out to me, wanting to know about, you know, Lane. And, you know, we heard some unfortunate news, you know, for Lane today. He's probably out for the year, at least until May the 8th. So if our guys get to the district tournament, we're able to advance, you know, Lane will be able to come back and join us in the region. You know, I really hate that for a senior,
yes,
you know, to have to go through that. But, you know, pregame, you know, we said do it for 12. And we're going to do it. Lane knows he's still going to be an important part of our team. You know, moving forward, he's a leader for our guys. And he did a great job in the dugout. And he you know, got our guys going there before the game, you know, and just overall, it was a really good team win for us tonight.
Yeah, Lane actually came up here and joined us for an inning as well. So we gave him our thoughts. We congratulated him on being here.
Yep.
Talked about tremendous season. He's had a tremendous career. One other player, at least, that I want to mention that's done well for the last 2 days, Morgan Clark.
Yes.
He's been on base six of his last seven attempts. What does that mean, like, also with your seniors?
You know, Morgan was our guy last year that led us offensively in average. And we were in Panama City week one, and Morgan had a really tough first couple of games, and I actually sat him. And I sat him just to see how he responded. You know, and I said, you know, it shows a lot about our guys when you're in the lineup. It's easy to play, but it's not easy to play when you walk over and you see yourself not there. And Morgan has responded since that night. He's come out and, you know, he's leading us offensively right now again. And that's exactly what I expect out of Morgan. You know, he was torn up last night, you know, with the throw that he made to first base, ended up going to the hospital with Lane. I think there were some tears shed, and, you know, as I understand that. But Morgan has responded since I sat him. And that's what I expect out of these seniors. You know, we've got nine guys. They all play a huge role in what we're doing, and they're taking on that leadership role. And I'm excited to see where this season ends for us.
All right, yeah. Congratulations once again, Coach. Now,
thank you.
You also brought up your winning pitcher,
yes, sir,
Langford.
Yes, sir.
So, Lane, come on in and join us up here, Lane. You can put it on anyway. If you want to pull the mic up just a hair, there you go.
Alrighty.
Congratulations on your big game tonight. What was going through your mind when you knew you were getting the nod to start and when you came in the seventh inning?
Well, you know, in situations like that and from past experiences, you learn how to handle pressure a lot better than times before. And Coach B has mentioned it many times to me that he will put me through situations specifically to learn how to handle pressure like that. You know, with stuff like that, you learn how to overcome, and really it comes down to throw strikes because there's nothing else I could really do as a pitcher and let everything fall into place. All that matters is I just need faith in my defense, and I have a great defense, and they'll try to run down any ball that gets hit. And I think that's just a great part of being a pitcher and just, you know, producing.
Right. I know you were there Monday when Fletcher went down. What did it mean having him out here with you today?
You know, it says a lot about a guy that – I mean, I've grown up with Lane, and seeing a guy who – you know, still has, you know, college potential, and he, you know, visiting college and everything, and you just don't realize how fastly that can be taken away from you. And it's a very real thing. And, you know, it says a lot for him to be out there. He held his head up when he told us today that, you know, he wasn't going to play for a while. And, you know, that says a lot about a teammate, and, you know, I love him, and the whole team does. He's a great leader. And really, it says a lot with what happened last night. That was a really big punch to the chest. It really killed the mood, and as it probably should. But for him to show up and be there for us as if he was going to play and keep his head up like he was going to play says a lot.
And the offense tonight, as well as the defense, what did that mean? Do you just see in 10 runs put on the board and just the way they played?
That really helps out a pitcher so much. It's just one of those things you just don't understand until you are on the mound that, you know, it's okay that, you know, if everything goes to fail, that, you know, I have a backup, and that's runs on the board. And it just allows smoother pitching, more accurate pitching, because when under pressure, you tend to tense up a little bit. And y'all know that's not a good thing. And, you know, it happens to people. But when you have people who are scoring runs and who are doing a good job at the plate, either way, it feels really good. And as a pitcher, yes, you know, myself, I didn't do so hot at the plate, but know that I have 8 other guys that are there that are willing to hit.
And not to put much pressure on you, I know Coach Boynton's here. I do this in front of Coach Stacy as well with them. How has he helped not only you but your senior class?
He's helped a ton. Yeah, it's the basics. I mean, you can't beat the basics of baseball. And we go through drills after drills after drills, and we go through situation stuff. And it's stuff that just needs to be handled to create a great ball team. And, you know, really just stuff like that, so that when we do get on the field, that's already work that we've put in, and it just seems natural to do things. And when we fail at, you know, a routine play, we do it again, and we do it again, we do it again, until we succeed, and we do it over and over and over again.
All right. Thank you for that. I want to say one more time, thank you for watching Clinton Dragon Baseball and Anderson County Maverick Baseball tonight at Merle Albright Field. We'll be back tomorrow night for Clinton Dragon Baseball against David.